All right, good evening, everybody. Thank you all so much for coming. I'm calling this meeting to order at 6:02 p.m. Tuesday, March 21st, 2017, in the community room at 970 Embarcadero Del Mar. I'd like to let everyone know that this meeting is being recorded for the record and to be made public in the future. And I'd like to ask Secretary Brandt to do a roll call.
Director Bertrand.
Present.
Director Jordan.
Present.
Director Brandt. I'm here. Director Freeman.
Here.
Director Hedges.
Present.
Director Geis.
Here.
Director Thurlow.
Here.
Okay, we have a quorum. All members are present. Now, item 1.5, approval of the minutes of the March 7th, 2017 special meeting. Has anyone here found any corrections to be made? Director Freeman.
Two corrections, one of which is that at the very end of the meeting minutes where the date of the next meeting is specified, it says February 21st instead of March 21st.
Ooh. Good catch.
And then the second one is if somebody could do a search and a place on the minutes for the word carried with one R to carried with two R's.
Okay.
Unless I'm like totally insane here.
Say that again.
Carries has two R's in it. Like every
yeah, you're
motion.
Right, you're right.
Yeah, okay.
Okay, so fix that typo.
Thank you.
Did any other directors find any corrections to be made?
Move approval.
Okay, motion made by Director Thurlow to approve the minutes of the March 7th special meeting. Do we have a second?
I'll second.
Okay, seconded by Geis. Again, the motion is to approve the minutes of the special meeting on March 7th. Any comment from the public? Lou Ann?
Mm-hmm. I would like to invite you to attend tomorrow evening at 6 o'clock at the Isla Vista School Multipurpose Room. We're having an educational forum on immigration. It's from 6 to 8 p.m. It will be in Spanish, but we're encouraging everyone to come as either a participant or an advocate for our community families.
Cool. Thank you so much. And we'll go back to that when we have general public comment. This is just for the approval of the minutes. All good. Sounds very exciting.
Public comment on minutes? Okay.
Just, we're voting on it.
We're very scrupulous.
Seeing no more public comment, any more board comment? Seeing none, Secretary Brandt, if you could call... we're just going to all vote without doing a roll call. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? No abstentions? So ordered. The minutes are approved. We're about to go into public comment. Before this, I am just going to kind of outline some guidelines that I hope we can follow in this meeting. The reason I'm doing this is because we do not yet have policies adopted for the order of the meeting, which we will be hopefully adopting tonight. But how I hope we can move forward with this is whenever a director would like to speak, please just place out your hand or raise your hand. I'll keep a queue of who wants to speak, and we'll go in the order in which I'm addressed. And for members of the public, if you have a comment when we go out for public comment, please just raise your hand, and I'll also mark you down in the order that I see it. For the public comment that is specific to agenda items, if you can come up here to speak, we'd prefer that. But if not, just wait until you're called upon, and it will be okay if you do it from where you're seated. But and then as far as once the board is discussing and ready to make a motion, we're only going to, after motion's made, the only thing that can happen is board discussion on it. Nothing else can be moved until we resolve that motion, unless it's a secondary motion. All of this will be made more clear when we actually discuss the board policies for meeting order in this meeting, but I just wanted to put that out there before we begin. Any questions?
I have one question. Is there a time limit on public comment?
There is no time limit on comment in for the duration of the section, but I will limit it to 2 minutes per individual comment.
Okay.
Director Freeman?
I would like to state my objection to 2 minutes.
Okay. Would you like to propose another?
I would propose at least 3 minutes.
Okay. I'm okay with 3 minutes. We will do 3 minutes for each public speaker. Thank you. All right. So now we are moving on to number two, public comment period. At this time, any member of the public may speak on items under the subject jurisdiction matter of the Board of Directors that are not on the agenda. The Board will not take action on any item not on the agenda except as provided by law. I see a number of people here who may want to speak. If you'd like to speak, please just line up next to the podium over here. And when you're ready to speak, just state your name for the record and then begin your comment. So anyone wishing to speak, just come up here, please. Yes.
Hello, I'm Jack Stafford. I'm a resident here in Isla Vista and a student at UC Santa Barbara. I've been sent here sort of as an unofficial representative of some of the tenants over at Campus 880, which is an apartment complex here in Isla Vista. We've been going through a lot of serious problems, not only with the property managers, but the land owner and property owner. A few of the problems are entry into units without previous notice, the use of open bed spaces as a right to walk into any apartment without any prior notice. People have been changing when people walked in. They call it an open door policy. They have been using evictions as threats consistently, holding eviction notices over tenants' heads and intimidating them in order to maintain their agenda and get either better reviews or better press. There have been inconsistencies with written warnings. There's been pretty much a lack of written warnings completely in any sort of formal way as far as complaints or warnings from management to tenants. And there's been a great deal of inconsistencies in the management, and we just believe that a lot of the things that they've been doing as far as holding eviction notices over residents' heads and the entry into units has been frankly kind of appalling. One of the managers this last week, when asked how many rights the tenants had, he said none. It's become a pretty horrific situation for a lot of tenants there, and we just wanted to bring it to public attention. So.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I guess I could elaborate on one time that he threatened somebody with an eviction.
And just state your name for the record,
please. I'm George Savis. I got into UCSB today.
Congratulations.
Okay, so I thought that it was all of our best friends. We have six friends in a unit. They all got slapped with eviction notices after a night of having people in their home before 10:30, which is when the technical quiet hours are, or the technical quiet hours are 1 in the morning on the weekends. And he recorded us, or she did, Melissa recorded us and everything. But so I just went over to speak with them about the situation when they were talking to Jonah, one of the people they'd evicted. And when I went over, I had said to Edward St. George, the property owner, that we could take him to court in regards to the actions he had been doing. And as I stated that, he looked at me, and I had received a ticket because I had an open container right outside the gate the night prior to that. And he looked at me, and then he looked at the manager next to me and said, didn't he receive a ticket the night before? And he said yes. And then he looked at me and said, slap him with an eviction notice. And then I didn't really know what else to say, so I got out of the conversation and walked away. But the grounds are, if you are arrested on 880 property, you can be evicted. If you get a ticket right outside the gate, you cannot be evicted. So I just wanted to elaborate a little bit of how he goes about dealing with his business.
Thank you. Any other members of the public wishing to speak? All right, well, thank you all so much for coming out and speaking on that issue. As that this wasn't part of our agenda, all we can do is listen to it. But Deanna Collins-Plente, who is here, I know that she is a friend of the Isla Vista Tenants Union, perhaps someone to meet up with. And also what I can say is that tenant mediation is something that's in our purview, and this is really helpful for us to consider as we move towards designing our services. So thank you so much for coming out.
Yeah, thank you.
All right, any other public comment? And Luann, if you could just leave some flyers in the back for the event that you mentioned, we'll be glad to check that out. All right, so that now concludes the public comment portion of the agenda. We're now moving into section 3, discussion and action items. And upon looking at this, I actually would like to move to number 3.4 first, the adoption of policies. Since, as mentioned before, some of those policies will affect the way in which we proceed in this meeting. Are there any directors up here who would be opposed to doing that first?
No.
No, I would just state that when a motion is made and passed, that motion needs to be reflected as a motion that is under item 3.1.
Thank you.
What?
Wait, could you make clear what you said, actually?
When you said you wanted to move to item 3.4 before we commence with section 3?
Within section 3, beginning with 3.4.
Yeah, you wanted to begin with, so you wanted to have a motion made to move to
No motion made, just moving to 3.4.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Okay. Thank you.
Yeah, okay.
Appreciate it.
Just wondering.
Yeah. Okay, so now in item 3.4, consider adopting policies recommended by the policy committee and consider directing a director to compile a policy manual. The board will receive the recommendations of the policy committee, provide suggestions for the recommended policies, make any necessary changes, and take action on the recommended policies. Such actions may include voting to adopt the policies. The board will also receive report from the policy committee and consider action on the structure and operations of the committee. So what we have here, and perhaps actually Mr. Freeman, if you would like to introduce this as the new committee chair of the policy committee.
So you would like me to read the
Well, if you would like to give a recap of our meeting and say what our intention is here today.
Okay. So the policy committee met, and what happened during policy committee is that Ethan and Spencer provided, who were the other two people on policy committee, I should point out, provided a set of sample policies for our district. We then spent the meeting time, which was over 4 hours, going through the policies that were provided by both Ethan and Spencer, and along with members of the public providing input, trying to massage them together into something that we were both comfortable with and that was cohesive. One of the major constraints that we put upon ourselves is that we didn't want to get ahead of ourselves. This is something actually Spencer was very adamant about, because if we start putting policies in place for things that we aren't really have necessity for on the board yet, we end up tying the hands of the board as far as how the board will end up going forward doing those things. And then separately, I pointed out an issue, which is that if we have policies for things that, for example, would require us to do something that we have no money to do, we can end up in a kind of a catch-22 scenario where we are just permanently out of policy. So the policies that we did end up putting forward for recommendation to the board to adopt are ones that are effectively just about operation of meetings and about the officers themselves, the position of president, vice president, and secretary, and what their general job function is, as well as some bare minimum compliance things that we understood we had to have, such as a reference to the conflict of interest policies that are in the state law. In the process of doing this, we ended up deciding to take each of the high-level groupings of policies and to break them down as individual recommendations, which then got turned into a large number of attachments. So we have attachments B, C, D, E, F, G, and H, and that then the board will each consider separately. And that will, of course, they'll be done under on this board, that'll be done under Ethan actually controlling that. Is there anything else that Ethan would like to add?
I'd like to make a motion that we consider all of them as one item as a consent calendar, unless specific board members or the public want to pull any of them out, but that we approve this 1 through 7 as one motion.
I'd second that.
Okay. And after this motion is made, if it passes, there would then be an opportunity for folks to pull?
I think that we should pull them out and then pass all the ones that haven't been pulled. So my motion would be that we approve it all, However, if there are items that need to be pulled ahead of the vote, that we go ahead and pull those, that you have the prerogative to pull those out, because I know you indicated that you might want to amend one or two.
Sure. Okay. So then, I guess what we can do is any director up here who would like to pull one, just mention what it is. I'll start off by saying that we should pull the number one because I noticed a spelling mistake that we should fix before adopting. So I'm pulling number one. Any?
To clarify the commentary about pulling things, are we also pulling them for discussion purposes, or like is this like similar to the Board of Supervisors where they will not even have discussion of items unless we pull them, or is this something where?
I believe that's what.
Yeah, I want to adopt these as a consent item.
Then the one that I want to pull I think it's number two.
Okay.
Attachment C.
Any others? Okay, so would you like to amend your motion to be specific to the
Yeah, I'll amend my motion to say that we adopt 3 through 7 and that we adopt 1 with the corrected spelling.
I second.
Okay.
Do you mind clarifying the spelling correction?
Yes, in one moment.
Take your time.
Typing the motion. Adopt 3 through 7 and
3 through 7 and 1 with a corrected spelling.
I have to read it back.
And I'll second that again.
Okay. And the spelling error is in sentence 2 it says I'll just read that first sentence. So, it is the intent of the Board of Directors of the IVCSD to maintain a policy manual. Contained therein shall be a comprehensive listing of the Board's current policies, big the rules and regulations enacted by the Board. That is supposed to be being, not big.
Okay. Big the rules.
I like big, but that's very big. Very large.
Okay.
So, we have a motion, we have a second. Is there any public comment? No public comment. Okay. So back to the board for discussion. I'll start off. I think that we should include in here some language just to make it very clear for the record. Adopt policies as listed in item 3.4A. I think if we add that to the beginning of it,
sure,
that would be helpful.
I'll accept that.
Second, accept that.
And what's the mention that we are going to have of item 2 that's just being left out of it?
That's left out. That's for, that's next. After this motion is after you call it. After Ethan J. wants.
So adopt policies from the agenda as listed in items 3.4A, 1, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7.
Correct.
With the corrected spelling of being in item 1.
Correct.
So that's the motion. Director Freeman?
I think it's clear, but just to verify for my sake, we did not include B in the consent calendar.
Correct.
B is another thing. The consent calendar.
Okay, we did not include B in. Okay, all right.
No. Okay. Is there any other language that directors would like added? No. Okay, calling the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered. Okay. Good job, everyone. We've adopted six policies.
The first policies ever.
And that's really a testament, I think, to the work that the policy committee was able to do. So I'd like to thank Director Freeman and Director Brandt especially for being so detailed in this and really putting in a lot of work. So now let's discuss 3.4A2, discuss and take action on the policy's recommendation that the board adopt a policy for the amendment slash adoption of policies. Director Freeman.
Ironically, this is the policy that would allow us to construct policies. So this is the one we put off until after we constructed all the other policies. So the only thing that I wanted to bring up on this one is whether we want to have it be a majority vote to construct new policies or a supermajority vote to construct new policies. This was something that I brought up during the subcommittee meeting. Jonathan said that in public comment that his natural inclination would be to have supermajority, but that there were reasons to lean towards majority due to our appointment elected cycle, but that I provide response to that. It's something that I could go into more detail on or not, but it's something that I thought we should bring to the entire board.
Thank you. Director Geis.
So a supermajority would be 5 votes?
Correct.
Four votes?
Correct. I'd say I'm personally in favor of just having a majority.
And that clearly was the position of policy committee, because mm-hmm. that's why we recommended the.
Any public comment? No public comment. Would anyone like to make a motion?
I'll move approval of number 2. I'm trying to find, is there actually language in there that says majority vote, or are we adding that at this point?
There is not language
attachment C
in there.
So I would move that we adopt the policy committee's recommendation board adopt a policy for amendment adoption of policies that would allow for a majority of vote to amend policies.
And I'll second.
Okay. Since, if I'm understanding this correctly, you're not trying to change the recommendation of the policy committee at all, right?
Since the board wants to know.
So then perhaps if it would be friendly, just vote making a motion to adopt the recommendation of the recommended policy of the policy committee, since that's not adding any new change.
Okay. Oh, I see. Okay, I was looking at the wrong attachment, so it is in there. Mm-hmm.
So that is moved by Thurlow, adopt the recommended policy of the policy committee in item 3.4A2, policy for adoption amendment of policies. And did we have a second on that?
I'll second.
Seconded
no,
by
there isn't one.
Geis. Any board comment? Any public comment? And Darcel, do you have all that? Cool. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered, 7-0. All right. So now moving on with this, the only part we have left in 3.4 is 3.4B. Consider taking action to compile adopted policies into an IVCSD policy manual and distribute copies to members of the board and public. So our thought on this was now we've approved these policies, which we're very grateful for all of your approval. And now we have to compile this all in a uniform way. I think what makes sense is for us to direct a director to do this. My recommendation would be that we direct the chair of the policy committee to be responsible for this. Is that something that the chair would be comfortable with?
I'm amenable, yeah.
Okay, so I'm
may I ask a question?
I have a question.
Okay.
Director Jordan.
Okay, my question was when it says distribute copies to members of the board and the public, do we mean printed copies or electronic copies? Just because if we were to do that, it should be done in a quarterly fashion or something like that in an effort to conserve our resources.
Yeah.
I think I just don't want to waste paper.
So for the time being, I think that it's going to have to be paper until the board takes action to create some sort of a website, which is another one of our agenda items.
That makes sense. You're right.
I think
never
we'll
mind.
Speak about it.
I take it back. But can we eventually think
no,
about doing
thing.
It potentially, like on a either like a tri-monthly basis or something like that, so we're not like reprinting them every week? Because unless we give a defined time period, I feel like then it's going to be kind of just like everyone's going to expect to have it provided to them at all times based on this language.
So, and perhaps what we're looking for here is for the individual directed to report back at the next meeting with a copy of this draft policy manual for approval. Like we've approved the policies, but perhaps we're looking, maybe that's something that we want to come back for the board and we can discuss the dissemination of the information at that time.
I agree.
That sounds good to me.
So I just had a question. Does the policy committee have like a general outline already of policies that you're planning to work on or what a comprehensive policy manual would look like? I mean, you looked at these other entities or other organizations, so are you, when you start putting these policies into a manual, is there a like a simulated table of contents that we're plugging into so that it's, you know, something reasonable that we'll expect out of it? Or if we're working on some information that really is a potential policy issue, do we have a vision that you guys are going to be working on that? That's what I'm just kind of like, for formation, I was trying to do that for us. Well, what is the inventory of stuff we're going to work on? But I don't know on the policy side if you guys are tackling it that way.
Well,
Director Freeman,
yeah, go ahead.
So what we've been talking about in policy committee is to essentially be looking at the immediate needs of the board, and then trailing the formation committee on the things that, so as formation committee comes forward and says that we need to be doing something with a certain kind of staff, then we need policies for staff. And so then we can start putting together the correct policies for staff in that policy committee meeting in order to get to the next board meeting. And then hopefully we can actually succeed in essentially having that ready in time for formation committee's need for it at the following board meeting. That this is something that, for example, there were a few items in the current policies that we were putting forward that mentioned staff. And it was like Spencer, for example, brought up that if we had that clause in it, that might actually tie the hands of formation committee in some way or tie the hands of the board in some way, and so we should probably not go that far ahead of ourselves.
Yeah, I was just thinking of when you look at other people's policy manuals or the California Special District's mm-hmm. policy manual, you know, they have a numbering scheme to it, and they have, I didn't know if they had general areas of policy that says, well, eventually we're going to be, you know, developing these accounting policies, and eventually we're going to be doing budget policies, and eventually we're going to, I don't know if that's what their manual looks like. I saw a piece of it today on the internet when I was researching something else, but go ahead, Jay.
Yeah, so interestingly, that was actually something that we tried to have on the agenda policy committee, but due to a mistake in the agenda construction, we weren't able to talk about a policy committee, and then it was going to be brought up here, and I was the person who was intending to bring up about numbering of the policy manual, but as soon as it became clear that I was just going to be the person who was going to be directed to do that, I figured I would not bother bringing that up because I would just do it. But if you want to discuss that, we can grapple discuss that.
Yeah, I was just didn't know what the vision of all these policies are, and so I was just, it might help the formation committee if we knew what the vision of what all these policies that maybe I haven't even thought of. I was looking at CFDC and, oh, conflict of interest policy and, you know, donation policy. I was really looking for a donation policy is what I was researching today. And I was researching the website for special districts and donation, and their CFD sample policy popped up.
Director Brent.
Bob, are you asking for a general kind of outline of what a policy manual would look like then, or are you asking what is it that we're going to tackle? Because I can tell you that I don't want to make policies on the policy committee that are in regards to things that are within the jurisdiction of another committee before that committee has parsed out the details of said program or thing, whatever it is. So, for example, we wouldn't make policies regarding an internship program because there's another committee under this board that's working on creating an internship program we would wait until the program is in place and then make policies that were consistent with the way that the program was being administered, and we would hope that it would be administered in the future. Because, and this kind of goes back to what Jay was saying about how I didn't want to be in the position where our committee is tying the hands of another committee, and also where our committees are speaking about, you know, the same things during the same week, because can get into weird territory. So the other thing that Jay was mentioning is that we wanted to stick to things that are very immediate. For example, these policies are board policies. Yeah.
I totally agree with the order you're doing them in. Yeah.
Okay.
So I'm fine with it.
Yeah. Sounds good.
Any other board comment? Okay, so then would someone like to make a motion directing Director Freeman?
Did I make that motion?
No, there was no motion.
All right, I'll still move.
So moved.
Go ahead. I'll second.
He just said so moved.
Okay, please state the motion.
Oh, I didn't know I was doing it. I thought I was seconding. Never mind.
Director
Freeman to prepare the
compile adopted policies.
Compile adopted policies into a
an IVCSD policy manual.
And report back to the board at the next meeting. Okay. Any public comment? Any more board discussion? All right, seeing none. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? All right, so ordered, 7-0. So we've now completed item 3.4. Now back to the top of the agenda for the discussion and action items. Item 3.1, Assembly Bill 722, Monique Lamone. The Board of Directors will review and discuss the latest amendment to Assembly Bill 722. And consider adopting a position of support for the legislation.
Point of information, did we skip 1.4 and 1.6? I'm sorry, I just didn't know if
excellent
we hit
point.
On those.
We did skip those.
We just didn't.
And that was not intentional. I would actually, I think since Gina, I know you would like to speak on 722. We'll go to this one first, and then we will go back to those.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for bringing that up.
I mean, I can wait.
Yeah, we can do it now. Thank
you. All
right.
I am being applied for. This is from the previous speakers. Okay. I didn't know if it was like directions or what.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
good evening. My name is Gina Fisher. I'm a district representative for 3rd District County Supervisor Joan Hartman. And I'm here. Apologies for not giving our office's letter of support to 722 earlier. I distributed them to all the members, and I have an extra copy with me. We discussed 722 in the last meeting, and so this is, to be very clear, this is a letter of support from the 3rd District Supervisor's Office to the California Legislature, and it outlines what SB 722 is in bold. It outlines very clearly the stated goal of it, and then there's a little bit of a historical background about the process of the formation of the CSD through AB 3, and now that the committee was formed, how 722 will help clarify some of the what we potentially anticipated legal challenges should we have moved forward to use the county's appointment for the 3rd District Supervisor. So are there any questions? Do you need me to give more information on that? I would urge that the board support 722.
Are you seeking a letter from the board in support to be addressed to
the I would urge that the board decide to support it and send a letter to the California Legislature, because
okay.
It's going to have to make its way through the legislature.
Okay.
And so, as you'll see, our letter is addressed to the legislature, and it will go through different committees.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Awesome. Any other board questions of Gina? Jay?
Do we have the final actual wording? Did I miss that?
That should be on the website. I didn't bring it, but the California legislature should have it on the website, and it's the language.
You want me to send you the link?
Was updated to reflect there has been an amendment. Like, the bill essentially is an amendment, and there has been an amendment to the amendment. Yes.
Do we know if there's any opposition to the bill?
Yet? I'm unaware of opposition at this time. I believe that there, from a body, I believe in the county's legislative committee. I'm not sure.
And then is the county's legislative committee going to take a position of recommendation to the full board?
They may.
They may.
They did.
And just to clarify, Gina, so this bill essentially just amends one line of what was AB3 and is now section 61250. And it's just the one line about declaring the offices of the third district supervisor and any other public officers of the county not incompatible with.
Right, that's the change it
makes.
Okay,
thank you.
So the exact, it would say that allow for notwithstanding any other law, a member of the Board of Supervisors of the County of Santa Barbara or any public officers of the County of Santa Barbara or their deputies would be able to serve as the county's representative to the IV Community Services District and not be considered an incompatible office.
Nice. Fantastic. Yeah. Any other board questions? Director.
And I'll stay up in case there's public questions. Yeah.
I have a couple points. One of which is I'm, brain's not functioning right now, but when you say, I should know this, when you say notwithstanding something, then we're saying that even though something else states that this would be illegal, this clause overrides that?
I think that notwithstanding any other law is more applicable to other, maybe, what's the word?
In spite of. Okay, all right, thank you. I just needed the definition of, I just forgot the definition of notwithstanding, and I just was sitting here trying to parse the sentence correctly. Okay, so.
Conflicts of interest, that was the word I was looking for.
Yeah, specifically 1090, California section 1090, which is, from my reading of it, makes this incredibly sketchy. I continue to be against this modification. So I, as stated at the board meeting last time, I was somebody who was, when we first put in the wording that stated that the Board of Supervisors would appoint somebody to this committee, I was stating that I would be much more okay with that if it were to actually be the third district supervisor. That was, however, when I was under the incorrect impression that the person serving on our board would be serving at the whim of the Board of Supervisors, in the sense that if the Board of Supervisors decided that they did not like the decisions of the person who was on the board that they appointed, they would be able to pull that person from the board and replace them. Essentially, that they would just, the Board of Supervisors would have a proxy on the board. However, the way that the law got written, and the way that actually, in a way, feels much more compatible with all of the existing conflict of interest laws, is that the Board of Supervisors appointed a position on this committee, on this board, in the same way that they might if there was an outstanding hole on a district that did not have quorum to appoint its own members, that Board of Supervisors might step in and perform such an appointment. And that appointment now is independent of the Board of Supervisors. So in our case, we now have Bob Geis. And if the Board of Supervisors decides that they don't like the decisions that are being made by Bob Geis, they can't actually pull Bob Geis. Which means that while Bob had worked with the county for a long time, he is now retired, and he doesn't act, he's not in control of, but he's not being controlled by anyone at the county. He's not of a salary that is coming from anyone at the county. He does not have any contracts with the county. He does not have any sworn fealty to the county. And so if we end up in a situation where we are negotiating a contract with the county, which was something that I anticipate we are going to be doing quite often, it does not introduce any awkwardness in the situation that we have Bob on the board. Whereas if we actually were to have the third district supervisor sitting on the board, or we were to have, worst case scenario, staff that might be from a high level ranking department that we are actually directly negotiating with, you can imagine all sorts of complex conflict of interest scenarios as we try to go into a closed session for negotiation or as we try to have any kind of discussion about that issue. So because of the way that the wording ended up working out in the state law, I then ended up deciding that I was not interested in having a third district supervisor be in the position. And then I will also point out that I've heard in the past that we've had third district supervisors that we don't like. We are very lucky that we like our current third district supervisor and that we like our previous third district supervisor. But we could always end up in a situation where we don't like our next third district supervisor, and then we are much more upset about the fact that we don't have that air gap between our board and the Board of Supervisors.
Can I clarify that if 722 passes, 1090, the rules and regulations around 1090 would still be in place to prevent conflicts of interest?
Can you clarify?
Director Freeman.
The rules and regulations of 1090 actually are the ones that state that this is an incompatible office. So they would not, this is notwithstanding that.
Director Thurlow.
Can you clarify this point about does the county's appointee serve independently of the county? In other words, once they're appointed with no ability to be removed by the county?
I don't have enough information to comment on that.
I'm appointed, if I may. I'm appointed to a 2-year term, but if the Board of Supervisors asked me to resign, that's my decision. If it was something that was against what my values are, I might not resign. But if it was to make things better, I'd resign and let them appoint somebody better.
Yeah, and my understanding is also that in this 2-year period that you're appointed, that is your discretion and your decision, not just in terms of your future service on the board, but in regard to anything that comes before you in your service.
Can I ask, Joan, is that your understanding that this is an independent position, independent of the Board of Supervisors?
My understanding, and we'll have to check back with County Council, but as Director Guy stated, the board as a whole appointed him, and the board as a whole could ask him to resign. And that's what we have done on a number of other boards and commissions, not ask people to resign, but appoint for a period of time. But if a new third district supervisor came in and suggested something to the board, it's possible that they would negotiate something.
Yeah, but could we get clarification on that from County Council? Because
we'll
I think that's a real important point.
And we can come back. Yeah. I just wanted to respond to a couple of things while I'm talking, if I may.
Thanks.
And the first is that it's our understanding that when AB3 was written, the idea was to have somebody from UCSB and somebody representing the county who could speak on behalf of these larger bureaucracies and bring resources to bear for the good of the CSD and the Isla Vista community. So if we just appointed from the county, we're very fortunate to have someone such as Director Geis, who has tremendous knowledge both of Ivy and the county. I can't think of anybody else like that. So if you have a third, if you have a supervisor or somebody from the CEO's office, you have much more ability to move the county bureaucracy. Director Geis has this over a long history that he's developed from his expertise in the county, but we aren't going to have somebody necessarily with those skills in the future. So what this allows is greater discretion, a larger pool as the years go by, so that we can appoint somebody who can best serve the interests of the CSD. We can look around and do that. Now the way it works in practice is that the third district supervisor, anybody can apply, but people do sort of look to the third district supervisor because it's in the district. And so there's some modest deference to that, so just in the appointment process. But I would strongly recommend having a wide pool to draw from, because we don't know in the future exactly what's going to play out and what kinds of skills, expertise, resources that we want to be brought to bear. I think Director Geis asked, or perhaps it was Mr. Director Thurlow, is there any opposition to this? In either the original form or the amended form or even AB3, LAFCO did not support it because it went through the legislature and they view this as a challenge to their turf and their authority. But it had to go through the legislature because it doesn't conform to traditional CSD structure. So we probably have an uphill battle there just because it's a turf matter. So that's the best I can do.
Thank you very much. Director Geis.
I just have two more comments. Director Thurlow's comment, can I be removed? If I do something stupid, they can ask me to resign. And you see that in many appointed committees. So, you know, I was elected for 25 years, and luckily I didn't do anything stupid. So, but, you know, you can find yourself in a position that you're not representing the county well, and I would accept that they would have to resign, and, you know, that happens. It's happening in the federal government all over the place today. As to, you know, what even in the first couple of weeks of me being outside the county now, you know, I have a lot of friends in the county, so I can get some things done. But I think Joe makes a good point. Someone inside the county on this board could probably, if it's the right person, could make more progress at bringing resources and solutions maybe, because you'd be able to get county staff to help you. I can't go to county staff and say, go do this for me, you know? So there is some, you know, givings on my part that this is good legislation for the future of this organization to have a great representative from the county that can help this district get stuff done. Has to be somebody very objective, but, you know, I don't see this legislation as being the way, sort of like Jay sees it, but I would accept this. I think it's a good idea.
I'll move that we direct the president of the board to write a letter in support of AB 722 to the state legislature.
I second that.
Can we amend that to include, can we just say all, like, can we leave it to the president's discretion at who he sends it to? Because I was looking through this the other day, there's a long list of committee chairs that needs to go to.
So you would just offer it to the authors, send it to the author of the bill, and then they would list it.
Yeah, that's what I
said. Okay. Yeah. Okay, so we have a motion to direct the board president to write a letter in support of Assembly Bill 722 to the state legislature. And that's made and seconded. Any board comment? Any public comment? Seeing no public comment, since I am not sure that everyone is going to vote the same way, we're going to do a roll call vote for this. Secretary Brandt, if you could call that.
Director Bertrand.
Aye.
Director Jordan.
Aye.
Director Brandt. I say aye. Director Freeman.
No.
Director Hedges.
Aye.
Director Geis.
Aye.
Director Thurlow.
Yes.
Motion passes 6-1, Director Freeman voting no. So ordered.
And that was for the president, right?
Yes.
Sure. Great. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Yes.
All right. So that concludes item 3.1. I'm very grateful for Vice President Jordan's reminder that we missed a few items in our introduction. So we are now going to quickly go to 1.4, reminder to directors about forms and trainings. Directors must complete Form 700. I know that many directors have done so. Once completed, those are to be returned to the County Elections Office. And once you file that, please bring a copy back to this board to give to the board secretary so that we can have this on file. In the coming weeks, the board can expect that we'll have a policy defining the keeping and publications of board documents such as that. but definitely just bring us back a copy so that should we receive any requests from the public, according to the California Public Records Act, to make that public, we are able to do so. As far as AB 1234 training, that is the ethics training. Has anyone gone online and found it on the?
I completed it.
You completed it?
Yeah.
Good experience?
Great experience. Great experience. 2 hours. Just clicking through. No, it's great. Yeah. It's by the Attorney General. It's
yes.
Online.
So how did she? So how did she enroll online? How do we
so
do that?
So you just go to, am I allowed to speak?
Please.
I'm sorry. Excuse me, Chair. So you just literally Google AB 1234 training. And then on the California Attorney General website, it's like basically a PowerPoint, and you log in with your email and a password, and then you have to do it for 2 hours. So take your time reading the slides, because you could literally like read it as slow as you want, and it still won't be 2 hours. And then there's just like little quizzes after each one,
okay.
But it's super informative.
And whose website is it?
It's on the Attorney General website.
Attorney General.
Mm-hmm. And if you finish in time, there's also extra supplementary trainings, too, if you really want to get into it. It's exciting stuff. So where do I put that when I'm done?
Yes, great question. So upon the completion of that, you have a sheet. And please print that out. And that's also a document to bring back to the board secretary to have on file.
Okay.
And that's
do
something
I have to
that I'll.
To county elections as well. I'm
that,
sorry.
That isn't something that you have to bring to county elections.
Okay.
That's just for us to have on file here, because so the state can see that you completed it, and we can see that you completed it here in the district.
And my question about the Form 700, if you don't mind me asking, is just, is it the exact same one that I filled out when I was running? Because it's the one that I filled out when I was running was super long, and he just showed one page. So,
and I'll respond to that.
Sorry.
It is the same form that we filled out while running. This does cover a different time period, however. The one that we filled out while running, I don't remember what the specific time amount was for that, but this one is everything within the past year of assuming office, if I'm correct. I mean, read the instructions, but that's how that's my unofficial advice on it. And why some directors' forms may be much simpler than others, you do not have to report any payments received from government agencies. So if a director works for a government agency, whether a local district, a university, another agency of the state or federal government, they do not have to report any
okay.
of that.
And so the date that is it the date that we were sworn in or the date that we were elected? Sorry, for I should probably ask this just to Hector.
That would be
okay.
great.
Sorry.
Yes.
Thanks.
But it will – oh, wait. It's definitely not when we were – it's not when we were elected. It's
okay,
for
so it's like today.
This is our assuming office Form 700.
Got it.
My question
bad.
Would
Thank
be
you.
Whether that was the date of formation of the district or the date of turning in
That's
your Form
a good
700.
Question. Thank you.
Okay.
And then 1825.
Yes.
Money.
Before we go there,
okay.
Director Freeman, did you have a?
I was about to. So let Natalie ask. That was good. I was going to do.
Yes, and so we're about to go to reports from member of the board, and one of the things
oh.
that I was going to mention is that I successfully applied for the free trial membership of the CSDA, and that
Ooh.
Is something that I recommend we wait until April 1st, which is the day of the start of our membership, to explore the resources that they offer for fulfilling that training.
Oh, awesome. Thank you.
I know
maybe
that
the sexual harassment training?
Yes.
Okay.
And that is also one that we will still be in compliance with the amount of time that is required to take. I believe it's the first 6 months. And it's for anyone who's receiving payment. And since none of us are receiving payment, it's actually, we're not required to take it yet, though I'm sure all of us out here believe that we should do that as soon as possible. But my recommendation is that we wait until that trial membership begins and see what we can get from the California Special Districts Association. Any other questions on board member forms and training? Okay, seeing none. Going over to 1.6, here reports from members of the board. During this time, if you just want to report on anything that you've done related to the CSD since our last meeting, and I'll just finish my report. Other than that, I've met with the policy committee and the internship committee, which we'll have a larger report from the internship committee moving forward. And then also I attended the formation committee meeting, not participating, but just listening to all the great things they had to discuss. Director Brandt and I attended an event by the Santa Barbara County Action Network At which point the Community Services District received the Local Government Hero Award. And on the flyer of the event, it said that honoring the Isla Vista Community Services District, I didn't realize that that meant we were actually receiving something. Upon arrival, or actually on the way there, Jonathan Abood let me know that we'd be making a speech. Spencer walked in 45 seconds before we went on stage. But we accepted the Local Government Heroes Award on behalf of the CSD. And then additionally, Congressman Carbajal surprised us at that event as well with a...
I was going to say, what's the can
Sorry. Well, Congressman Carbajal, who we actually have his representative, Elijah Edinger, here, he gave us a congressional recognition certificate for the community service provided by the CSD. And I don't remember what the exact
award
was.
For congressional, special congressional recognition. And I'll just say, I apologize for not bringing both copies of these awards. They look really pretty, and I was going to bring them to the meeting tonight, but I forgot, so sorry.
But they're in safekeeping until we have an office, right?
They are.
Fantastic. That's the end of my report. Vice President Jordan?
I took a great training on ethics and learned a lot about it this week. It was great. That's my report.
Wonderful. Yeah. Secretary Brent?
Yeah, so I had the opportunity to meet with both of the committees. I'm on the policy committee and the formation committee. I also attended the internship committee as a fly on the wall, as they say. I think that there was a lot of great work done in the committees, and I'm really happy with the way that the committees worked this week. I just wanted to make the one broad point that I think we kind of touched on a little bit earlier, which is that it's going to be really important for us to be communicating during our board meetings about what territory our committees kind of have jurisdiction over, so that we don't step on one another's toes. Not just for, you know, the whole idea of stepping on one another's toes and say, like, making policies about something that formation committee is working on or something like that, but also because it's strange territory, to put it charitably, in terms of the Brown Act, for what issues can be discussed outside of public meetings by a quorum of the board. So that's my report. I look forward to meeting the committees again.
Yes, and one more thing that I'll add that I just remembered from hearing your Brown Act disclaimer. Since right now all of our committees are three members, it is my understanding that the Brown Act must be followed particular to that, not only as a member of the Board of Directors, but also as a committee member, which means that if there were ever two committee members speaking on something outside of a meeting, while that wouldn't be violating the Brown Act for our Board of Directors, that would be a violation for the committee. So it's important that as long as these committees remain standing committees subject to the Brown Act, no directors can be in contact with each other outside of the committees. And next, Director Hedges.
Since all I had to do that I might report is that I was contemplating myself about the matter of outreach, I'm fairly sure there were no Brown Act violations in that. I did make some notes to myself, and so here again, I'm fairly sure I'm on solid ground. And that's really all I have to report.
Cool, and we're excited to discuss the community engagement later in the meeting.
That's right.
Next, Director Freeman.
So are we part of this is a reporting contact we had with other board members?
No.
No.
Okay. I'm trying to think if I have anything particularly...
I mean, if you would like to report that, you're more than welcome to.
Yeah, I'm trying to think if I have anything particularly interesting to report. I mean, I've been attending all of the... I guess I now know of more of them, so now I can only say I've been attending half of the ones that I know about, various outreach meals in the community. And so I see Father John at those. And I've been making certain to hand out copies of our agendas and for the committees and for the board meetings at those, and board packets, and trying to collect feedback on things. But that's all just me talking to people. Of course, as Spencer mentioned, I have been attending committee meetings, I attended the one committee meeting that I was on, and then I
actually not attend, but just video record the other two committee meetings, but watch those videos.
Where can we find those videos, Jim? Sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, excuse me.
Ask during 3-5.
Sure. All right.
I guess I don't have anything I feel that's particularly official to report.
Okay. Director Thurlow?
Nothing.
Director Geis?
Just two issues. I've had a couple of contacts. One was I talked to the county about insurance, and what I was inquiring about was, could I buy personal insurance for myself? But they turned around and informed me, since I was a member appointed by the board, that I was insured, at least where I won't lose my house. And so from that point, though, then we started, they did recommend that the district get coverage, and we discussed a little bit about what types of coverages, which I think it should be a discussion with the full board. What do we think we need to be insured for? Where's this business going? And then I did forward to our president the contacts of how we could get a quote from the county's insurer. Our risk manager at the risk manager at the county has helped other special districts get insurance, and so that's a good thing to do. And I also think we should look for some more quotes, like from the California Special District Association. So I didn't know, Ethan, if you wanted to refer that back to the formation committee, and then have the formation committee work on an agenda item for insurance, and maybe send out some preliminary quotes.
Yes, and so the reason that I did not respond to that was because it is something that's been assigned to the formation committee to look into insurance.
Oh, okay.
And I think that it needs to go through the committee process and then come back to the board before I can receive any direction.
Okay, so I forgot. I didn't know it was assigned.
No,
so
not that one.
It's back in my hands. So.
Cool.
And then the last thing was, I did contact the supervisor's office, who about that office space. And I know they had some discussions with our CEO, who then I put in a call to the CEO. They recommended I call the CEO. And I think the difficulties about that office space, if you understand these buildings, number one, they're being paid off by redevelopment agency bonds. So the county, we got lucky, actually, in that process. We were skilled legally to get these buildings in the county's name so that we didn't lose them and have to sell them through the redevelopment agency process. But in terms of doing that, we also have to comply with these lease document, these bond documents, that we can only lease these to government agencies. And when they leased the upstairs in some of the buildings, they went through a public process to put the right tenants in there, and they are paying tenants. And that's help covering the cost of managing the buildings and all that. So there's a little bit of a procedure problem just to turn around and say, well, we could take that building and give it to a government agency for $3 for 3 years, is what I was asking for. I was trying to use my old influence. And so I don't think that can work. I think we're going to have to go into a lease process, and since we don't have any money, we probably wouldn't be maybe a successful bidder, and I don't know if the county wants to lease that. But my own reflection on this, I think we should take maybe Peggy's recommendation at our formation committee when we discuss this, and maybe we should try and treat that space, if the county's not using it, like this space, which would be available to the community, and it would be probably a shared space. We probably couldn't have it for our own office. But the door's not completely closed on that. They're still doing some research at the CEO, but that's kind of my feedback.
Cool, and I'm sure we'll discuss that later on in more depth with the formation committee item.
Yeah, we didn't bring it back to the formation. They just directed me that I could go talk to the county.
Oh, fantastic.
We didn't want to offend the process somehow.
Thank you for all your work on that. All right, anyone else have anything to add? And one more thing that I'll add to mine, I was also very privileged to meet with Supervisor Hartman. She took her time to speak to me about chairing the board and also some of the work of the IVCSD, and I really appreciated it, and it's been very helpful for this meeting, so thank you.
I'm seeing a rack in my brain just thinking, I failed to index my head correctly as far as reports. I have other meetings that I had, but they weren't official meetings, clearly, and I mean they'll end up being discussed later on the agenda, cool. So should I just leave for them?
That sounds fine. Thank you. Cool. All right, so now getting back on course, item 3.2, discuss current and future funding options for the district, discuss UCSB's pledged contribution, opportunities for grant funding, and a ballot measure for a utility user tax. So this was something that was on our first agenda, and we didn't have time to speak to it in depth, so we've brought it back to give an opportunity for any directors to discuss their thoughts and ideas about our current funding situation and what we may do in the future to change that. This is also an opportunity for members of the public to ask questions that perhaps members of this board have answers to. Is there any director who would like to make a statement or start this discussion?
Yeah, I'll begin.
Actually, I saw Director Freeman's hand first.
I was going to ask, I imagine that this is going to be an ongoing agenda item, essentially, on our, because this is something that we're not likely going to solve today, and is something that we are going to likely continue to have issues with going forward, and so I can expect that this will, for example, be back on the next agenda.
Absolutely. I think that's something we should solidify at the end of the meeting. Director Brandt?
Yeah, so I was just, I'll start off by saying I think it's really important that this is a standing item on the agenda because the status quo right now of our situation where we don't have any sort of a dedicated revenue source, I don't need to say it, but it's not sustainable. It's not going to provide the sustenance that this district needs growing forward to grow into an institution of Isla Vista. There are things, and I'll continue to state it for everyone in attendance, this district is required by law to pass a utility user tax by the year 2023, or the district dissolves and does not exist. I think it's really important that we do that. So I think that in the short run, the most pressing thing that I would want to hear a little more about would probably be from Director Thurlow regarding the process by which UCSB's $200,000 contribution for services and mutually agreed upon projects and is going to be spent. Can you speak a little bit to that?
I don't have an answer for you. I think that what the district has to do is to prioritize its needs. I would recommend that you, I don't know, rule me out of order here, Mr. President, but I think we need a finance committee. Ultimately we'll have a finance committee to look at budgets, but I think it would be good to have a finance committee. I think that some committee, and I guess it would be formation committee right now, but a future finance committee should prioritize what the needs are. It seems to me the insurance issue is going to be a huge priority. And it's also going to be one that potentially could be thorny for the university to buy insurance for this board. But I do think there needs to be priorities put in place. Until this board has ideas about where it wants to go, the university is not going to put forward an agenda for where it wants to spend the money. And in fact, quite the opposite. It's totally going to take a passive role and wait for this board to make suggestions. So I think that's the best. And there really have been no discussions at UCSB about where to spend the $200,000. I know that's probably hardly believable, but the fact is everybody's waiting for this board to decide what it needs.
And well, here, I'm going to make a comment real quick, and then I'll call on Director Freeman and then Director Brown. that actually I would like to see going forward as have a more defined process for making such a request, but I am excited to hear the facts that the university is truly waiting to hear the will of this board and find common ground to move forward. That's something that I definitely appreciate.
Yeah.
But I would like to ask if perhaps in the future, at a next board meeting, you could maybe let us know of a tentative process for approaching the university on the funding matter, or it doesn't need to be at the next one, but that's something that maybe can be worked on.
You're really putting me on the spot.
I mean, you're...
No, I'm just kidding. I'm just... it coming up with a process for the university to spend money, which is totally unprecedented in the university's history, is a lot to ask, but here's what I would...
Oh, I meant a process for us to request it.
Right,
not,
well, that's
not
what
a
I mean
process
is
for it to be spent.
Who would that request go to, and what would be the time frame for a response, and what would that response entail? I mean, those are all things that the university has not thought about. So what I would suggest is the board take, and I don't know, again, I would suggest that the board authorize the president to write a letter to the chancellor asking for direction on how he would like to proceed, or, you know, essentially how he would like to handle this grant and who he would like to designate to be. And I think that will start the process.
So moved.
I'd second that.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. And I tried to write all that down as we went along. So
sorry.
The board authorized the board president to write a letter on behalf of the board to the chancellor, asking the chancellor how to
proceed
with requests for funding from the $200,000 grant. And that'll start the process going on. And I don't think my sense would be is that there's not going to be a real formal process to this.
Cool. And I'd like to ask if maybe it would be amenable to the maker and second to change it from 200,000 grant to 200,000 pledge contribution.
Yes, that's great.
Yes.
Thank you.
As a reminder.
I like that.
Well, they're uncomfortable. Actually, they're uncomfortable with the word grant. So pledge is better.
That's
grant implies that it's done and it's spent. So.
And should it be from the annual $200,000
no,
plus contribution
not.
For the first time? Okay. All right. We'll take this
year.
We're
really
pushing
the envelope.
Okay. Yeah. All right. So then we have.
You
we,
know
we
I'm
going to
be summoned when this letter shows up over there.
Well, I initially thought this should just come from you.
Yeah.
But, okay.
No.
So we have a motion. We have a second. Any other board discussion?
Should we include the? Sorry.
I had a hand.
Go ahead.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Director Freeman.
I mean, at what point do we start to feel like what we're doing here is we're reminding the chancellor that we actually have this money and maybe we want to actually spell out more details about them? I mean, it was almost a joke that we were having, but maybe actually that is a goal, or is that not a goal?
Don't we have to just start the conversation, get the ball rolling, see what happens?
Yeah.
Are we all on the same page?
Yeah. I was going to say, should we include the university's representative on our board in that conversation? Because right now it doesn't seem like...
Can
George
you CC the board members?
No. That would be a serial meeting.
Never mind.
But should George be included in this conversation? If the goal, as we've been discussing in the context of Bob and the county's appointment, was so that the person can be involved in moving the bureaucracy, then it would make sense to include George in those discussions.
I'll be included. Don't worry.
Okay.
Yeah. No. But the idea is that you're writing to the head of the university to say, and he will assign this to people.
Yeah.
He will not personally get involved in it. He'll assign it.
Yeah.
And it'll get the ball rolling. And then I think the very next thing we need to be doing is working on a list of priorities. And here are projects.
Thank you, Director. Guys.
You know, I'm working on another project. In another organization, and with a very wise guy that I'm following, and what he
is emphasizing to that organization is it's up to us to start thinking about this service delivery model for the CSD, that we have to decide what it is that we're going to do, you know, what it is we want to accomplish in terms of service delivery before we apply money to it. Then that might limit what we can do, but we really have to spend some time on those things that we're empowered to do and figure out where we're gonna go. And that might even be a 2 or 3 year plan or a 5 year plan when the utility user tax could kick in to how we get to our goals about delivering these services and then prioritize to the university what George is saying. Here's our priorities because we want to accomplish things in the next 2 years for service delivery. We want to deliver stuff to the community and that's what that contribution is for and we need their buy-in to that. And so I think we have a lot of legwork to do on service delivery before we just go say, well, give us 200,000, then we'll decide what to do with it. It's backwards. You've got to go the other way.
And Director Geis, with that in mind, do you think it's too early to send this letter asking about the process?
I don't think it's too early to ask the university to get engaged into the process. But I think we need to decide on our own side what our process is going to be about service delivery and really, really say how are we going to, the first thing we have to engage in is how are we going to pay for some administrative expenses.
Can we talk about that in formation? Is that something that would be handled by the formation committee or the board of directors at large? Creating those processes. And just on my motion alone, I feel like it's a comfortable time to move forward with sending this letter. And if looking at our newly approved attachments here, the policy recommendations, I'd motion to close debate and vote immediately. Can I do that?
You absolutely can.
Okay,
thank
great.
You for using it.
Welcome. I'm excited about that.
I think you should have asked for some public comment.
Well, yes, because we do need all the public
comment.
Intent.
I forgot about that.
So
go ahead.
I knew Natalie would first use that.
Oh, yeah. And it's going to come up again, I promise.
Before we go to the public, any more board discussion? No, okay.
Are we actually using something? Because we have to have a second for Natalie's motion, then we have to do it.
I rescind my motion.
Okay.
I don't rescind my original motion. I rescind my
secondary.
Wait, who seconded?
Okay, at this time we're going to do public comment. Jonathan Abood.
I don't want to put you on the spot, George, but it's the middle of 2017 almost. If the 200,000 doesn't get spent, do you think it'll roll over?
I was waiting for somebody to ask that question, which is when does the clock start ticking on the 200,000? And I don't think we have a sense. There's no. But the fact is that we've agreed to 7 years of 200,000.
Okay.
So 7 years from now.
I'm just interested. Thank you.
I had another question or comment on what Director Geis said. I think we have something in terms of setting priorities. We have something to go off of in terms of the service plan, which was designed based on 6 months, 7 months of meetings, which does assume that the tax passes, but all the ideas within it are what everyone discussed in this room in terms of like how to do policing, how to do community planning. So,
right. So,
we can go off.
Just the service plan hasn't been discussed with the entire board. I'm not aware of that. So,
right.
Do you have a copy of it? Can we send you one?
Sure.
Okay, I can do that.
Awesome. Any other public
comment? Just send it to the formation committee. Yep, and I'm the chair, so.
Okay, I'll send it to the formation committee. Congratulations,
no
chair.
More public comment? Okay, Beth.
Oh,
Darcelle?
I do want to point out that George always said it was going to be a total of $1.4 million for the university. So I think it does roll over.
I love that point of information.
Jay, turn the camera off,
please. Okay. No more public discussion before coming back to the board? Seeing none, back to the board. And this discussion is just related to this motion at hand. Any members wishing to speak? All right, we are now ready to call the question, and it's a motion made by Jordan, seconded by Hedges, that they move that the board authorize the board president to write a letter on behalf of the board of directors to the chancellor of UCSB, asking the chancellor how to proceed with requests for funding from the $200,000 pledge contribution. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed?
And
none.
I'll
any
abstain.
Abstentions?
I'll abstain.
One abstention, Thurlow. Motion passes 6-0-1. Fantastic. So we have now that decision made. Are there any other things we want to discuss within item 3.2 before moving on, related to the utility user tax or grant funding? Director Freeman?
Well, I wanted to continue talking about the, we went into that motion, and so then I was actually on the stack right earlier. And so then I, some of this has been brought up, but there's, so I keep hearing that there was an MOU that was actually done with the university. I don't know if that MOU actually happened. Like, there was an MOU, like, was there actually something that we call an MOU? And if so, with what entity was that MOU negotiated with? Like, was it the office of Doss Williams? Was it the county of Santa Barbara? Was it, and can we as the board actually get a copy of whatever was actually negotiated, if there actually was a document or anything that was put together?
Well, there was the letter that was.
There's a letter.
Yeah,
yes.
There was the letter.
Oh, so that letter was, okay, and I do remember, okay, I remember that letter from AB3. I think
yes.
We should probably actually get that as a something so we can attach that to our agenda for the next board meeting so that the public can have that and we can talk about
sure.
it.
Sure. That'll be great. And it's also available to be found in the financial feasibility study.
I remember that letter now, and I've got copies of that letter in various places. So.
But I agree that would be great to bring to this agenda. And it's just a letter pledging the contribution from Chuck Haynes, Director of Capital Development, to then Assemblymember Williams.
And part of the reason why I was curious about that, and actually I don't think the letter, though, does do this, is that I would like to know where in the university bureaucracy our money is technically currently sitting. Like, is it at the Office of the Special Advocate for Isla Vista? Is it something that is coming out of an account at the Chancellor's office? And is something that, like, is it something that, like, just exists ephemerally and they know they owe it to us? Like, I'm wondering, like, where in their whole accounting process our $200,000 is supposedly sitting?
Is that a question any directors wish to answer?
It's a $600 million enterprise, and money sits in it. And trying to locate this $200,000 would take me and eight other people years. And I'm sure that Bob will back me up on that. The letter is a pledge, and the letter is signed by the guy who's in charge of all of the money at UCSB. And so he has put his name on that pledge. Where the money is, I would have to assume that the money is going to come from private sources, because I'm not sure that we can spend, I don't know this, but I'm not sure we can spend taxpayers' money on the CSD.
And I think that all is lumped back into the whole letter, and I feel like if we're going to be talking about, especially like the $200,000, I could be wrong, but it seems like from what you know is about the letter. And that's kind of seeming like the extent of it. So I think a lot of this could come back to maybe suggestions for Ethan of what to put in the letter more than like a question and answer thing
right.
to George.
Yeah.
Could I be right? Am I right
yeah.
on that
yeah.
one?
Yeah.
Sorry.
I think that's great.
Well, I thought we were done with the letter and we were moving
yeah.
on to Bob had some other ideas about where to get some money.
I just had a question. Under this opportunities for grant funding, do we consider donations grant funding?
Ooh, that's a good question.
We can have a little discussion on donations.
Am I allowed to donate? So, like, let's say theoretically I wanted to donate, like, $5. Can I get my funding?
Unfortunately, I think with the narrowness of how we describe this, maybe we should stick to grant funding.
That's my bad. Sorry for tying our hands.
But
well,
in the future, absolutely.
Can we direct the formation committee to discuss grant funding and donations?
Yeah.
Okay.
Is that a motion?
Yeah, make it a motion.
Sure. I'll move that we direct the formation committee to explore grant funding and donations, and in particular whether they're tax deductible or not.
They are.
Are they?
And I'll second that motion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so the motion that I have right now, made by Thurlow, seconded by Brandt, is move that we direct the formation committee to explore grant funding and donations, and in particular, whether they are tax deductible or not.
That's
the motion. Any other board discussion on it?
That's a great question, and I'm glad we included donations in that. Because as we were sitting here, I was just thinking, you know, what if I wanted to start paying my tax unlevied ahead of time?
That's a great idea.
You know, just
no,
as a...
No, that's a great idea.
You know.
That we start...
Throw
we
it in there.
Yeah.
Pay my tax a year ahead.
Oh. There we go. That's a great idea.
Any public comment? Mr. Kennedy?
Might I include in the motion... enlisting a nonprofit to make sure you have 501c3 donation possibility.
So, is that something that Maker and Second would like to include?
So, sure. Say that again.
So, collaborations with nonprofits?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Is that's the spirit of it?
Yes.
Okay, so. Grant. So, move that we direct the formation committee to explore grant funding and donations. Collaborations with nonprofit organizations, and in particular, whether donations are tax deductible or not?
Yes.
Okay, that's friendly with the maker in the second. Okay. Any other public comment? Jonathan?
The voluntarily pay your tax idea, I think, is going to be a big one. So. I think all directors should do it to like show an example.
Yeah.
You know, eventually you get to that point. So.
Yeah.
What was that?
Start with
paying. Not only do you not get a statement,
so there.
Any other public comment?
Conflict of interest?
Yeah.
Okay, no public comment. Any more board discussion on this motion? Okay.
I think Bob and George pay the tax too.
No,
they
don't.
Makes sense.
I don't know if it's part
George
of this motion. No, let's go ahead.
Okay, so the motion is that we move direct the formation committee to explore grant funding and donations, collaborations with nonprofit organizations, and in particular whether donations are tax deductible or not. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered, 7-0, motion passes. All right. Director Thurlow, did you have a point to bring up outside of the motion?
Yeah, 2 points. First point is, let's take a break. And the second point is, but that's president's prerogative. The second point is that I noticed in reading this material that we need a taxpayer identification number. So can we direct the secretary to apply for a tax identification number for the Community Services District?
Do
we need a motion for that?
That would need a motion. Would you like discussion before it, or do you want to move that?
So moved.
Okay. So the motion is to direct
the secretary to first determine if we need one. It appears that we do need a taxpayer identification number, and then second is to simply apply for it. I don't think it involves any money.
In the long term, if we have employees, we have to have a tax ID.
Right.
Could I ask where this is? You're getting this from the code?
Yeah, I think you would get it from the Secretary. Well, let's see. Is it from Franchise Tax Board or from the Secretary of State?
Tax ID number would be from
from the IRS. Yeah. But I know I'm asking where are you seeing this like necessity?
That necessity would be if you were going to take on the donation side, and that necessity would be if you're going to have employees. So you have to have a tax ID.
Sounds good.
Okay. And, well, I guess we need to ask the secretary, is this something that you think is appropriate for your role? Is this something you think should be kicked to the formation committee to come up with a more detailed proposal? Is this something that you think you can take on at this time?
I think it's definitely something I can take on. I've gone through this process before. It takes about 15 minutes, so.
Yeah.
Really?
Great to hear.
Wow.
You just have to, it's actually.
How efficient.
It's a big deal, though, because you have one, the same one for the rest of your life.
Yeah.
Of the agency.
Yeah. I find it kind of funny that you have to go and do it in between, I think it's like 10 a.m. and 4 p.m. You would find this interesting. There's like hours of operation
online
for the website. Yeah, for the website, yeah.
Okay, any more board comment before we go out to the public? Any public comment on this matter? Seeing them back to the board, any more board discussion?
This is on that motion?
Yes.
Yeah.
Cool. Okay, so motion to direct Secretary of the Board to determine if we need a taxpayer ID number and for the Secretary to apply for one. Second, made by Jordan, seconded by Thurlow. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered. This motion passes 7-0.
Could I just make a comment on 3.2? If we're going to keep this 3.2 as a standing item on the agenda, maybe we should broaden it to include all sources of revenue and opportunities for funding so we can have a bigger discussion of things that aren't limited to that.
Yes. And I think that's something that me and Board Secretary will be very happy to do for future agendas. Any further discussion on item 3.2? None? Okay.
I would say that I agree with George's sentiment that we should go for a quick break.
Oh, yes. So we are now ending item 3.2, and I am calling a short recess of approximately
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
5 minutes.
Yeah.
All right. 7:32. We are now standing in recess. We'll answer your question when we come back. Okay. We are calling this meeting back into session, coming back from the recess at 7:40 p.m. If all directors could take their seats.
Elijah, can you close the door? Thanks.
Huh?
Oh yeah, Brenna.
Like actually open because it's cold. Like open.
My board always needs the door open.
Leave back door open.
It's not because it's cold. It's because there's bugs flying in here. Okay, all directors are now back. We are in order.
Let's rock it out.
Now moving to item 3.3, consider adopting a calendar of future meetings. And this is coming from Secretary Brandt.
Yeah, so I can speak to this a little bit. So attachment A on, or within the agenda packet, is a calendar that I mocked up. The first thing I want to say is there's a purple space on May 29th. Just ignore that and pretend like it's not there. That was my hastiness in putting this together. I forgot. What did you say?
It's your birthday.
Is it? Actually, it's very possible that is that Memorial Day? Or
yes, it is.
Okay, that's the reason why it's purple. Never mind. Don't ignore it. Just keep that as a point of reference.
Oh my gosh.
So I guess I just didn't put it on here. So the green spaces, as you can see right now, we're on Tuesday the 21st. The green spaces are things that the board has already set. The board has already set that these will be regular meetings. They will be occurring unless the board takes action to cancel them. So that's not something that we would need to take action on. The calendar is twofold. Number one, it's just for visual sake for members of the public and for the board so that we can have this kind of laid out over a period of months. What I presented before you today only goes through May and a little into June. And my thinking with that was that we just want to lay out what's in front of us for the next couple of months, and obviously, so for example, like June 20th, even though it's not a green space, that's still a scheduled meeting because it's the second Tuesday in the month of June. The blue days on the calendar are potential working days for committees, meaning that they are a Monday through Friday day, and there would be what I perceived was ample opportunity to notice said meetings if they occurred during these days. Orange is the spring break for Santa Barbara City College and UCSB, so I put that on there as a point of reference, along with the purple, which is Memorial Day. And lastly, red I have on there as potential special meetings. So this is what I'm truly bringing before the board, is the proposal for these two special meetings, and I can speak about each of them individually. The first for April 6th, I think that in some of the conversations we've had this evening and hearing what has been said in the community and looking at how we did not get to go into discussion regarding the 90-day plan or anything that would allow us as directors to really kind of purvey what our vision is for services for this district, I thought that it would be good to schedule some sort of an April 6th meeting to be sort of a visioning workshop where Director Bertrand and I can present the document that we co-authored. Any other directors who have their own ideas can present them. And we can just kind of go through also, as Jonathan mentioned earlier, the plan for service, which is based on doing exactly that for something like six to nine months. So that, I think, would be a great opportunity for us to really dig into that stuff, seeing as our agenda is full with what I would say is sort of items that are related to our newfound status as a district rather than actually anything services related. The other special meeting is May 25th. My reasoning with this is that May happens to be a month where there are five Tuesdays, and the board took action to schedule regular meetings on the first and third Tuesdays. I figured that it might be good to set a May 25th special meeting so as not to interrupt the regular flow that we had going on and not hamstring us by having meetings that are 2 weeks apart from one another as opposed to 1 week apart from one another. These proposals are both things that I would love to hear everyone's input on, but again, also just the reason that I brought a calendar is because I think it's really important that we release some sort of a calendar, whether it's in online form, which I know we'll be talking about later in the meetings, or just distributed around Isla Vista. We want to make sure that members of the public know when our meetings are being held, specifically since they're new meetings, and a lot of people are just unsure what the general schedule is. Any questions, comments?
I can't make it on the 6th. Sorry.
No worries.
That's okay. I just want to let you know that. And then on the 25th, depending on what time it is, I think I might be able to make it, but that's not a hard thing either, just because of my work schedule.
Okay. And may I ask why there's not a third Tuesday meeting in June?
That was because I just forgot to make that space green.
Okay.
And it was also because my intention was really only to go through these next 2 months, April and May, but I think I ended up putting in the green for the first date in June to symbolize, just to kind of be a bookend to the fact that there are 2 weeks preceding it where there are no meetings taking place.
Got it. And so my initial thoughts on this are, I think it is helpful that we look at when we are going to have these meetings, especially the May 25th, that's really helpful to recognize just how the days flow with the calendar. But I think that perhaps we should just vote on those specific dates, because I think releasing a calendar is going to tie into a future agenda item of directing us to potentially work with the Isla Vista Community Development Corporation to put out a website. I think within that we'd have discretion to create a calendar, but if other directors think that we should vote to adopt this in particular, that could be done too. Director Freeman?
I think we can put documents out without having a website. I mean, like we put out agendas without having a website. We put out minutes without having a website now. So, I mean, like I feel like we can adopt a calendar and put it out before we decide about the website part.
Oh, absolutely. I was just saying that maybe it wasn't necessary to make that in a motion, but that was just my personal thought on that. Director Geis?
I just think the more planning we can have to have time set aside on our agenda is better for old guys like me. I would like to see the same thing for our formation committee. Hey, here's where we're going to meet, and then that tells me when I have to get agendas done and work done, and
take time, make sure that works into whatever my schedule is. So the more routine it is, or the more vision forward, you know, that really helps out.
Director Jordan?
I just can't make it on the 6th. That's it. Yeah. Sorry.
Nor can I, for that matter.
Director Brandt?
So regarding the 6th, it sounds like that's not going to be a date that would work. I'll say at the outset, I think it would be really awesome if we were able to have this sort of visioning special meeting, whatever we're going to call it, during the week from the 3rd to the 7th, just because of the fact, and so preferably it would be either on the 6th or the 7th. Maybe that's not going to be possible, though. Maybe we push it to the next week. I just think it would be cool to have something that would coincide with the beginning of the spring months. People are just generally more active and interested in getting engaged. Particularly, it's the beginning of UCSB spring quarter, so I think that would be good. Maybe, how does everyone feel about the week of the 10th to the 14th, and what availability is like?
I've given you my Tuesdays. Tuesdays are my CSD day. So,
as in the 11th as well?
I could do the 11th, or probably the 11th would work best.
The 11th would work best for me.
11th
also
would work for me. Awesome. That
is the
11th
good with you guys?
Yeah, the 11th's good for me.
All right, I think awesome. that's my suggestion there.
Yeah.
That's great. And then, so in regards to the 25th, do we want to institute some sort of a special meeting so that we fill that gap where there won't be any meetings?
I'm sorry, which one are we? The week of the 22nd?
Why don't we put off discussion of that? Why don't we just wait?
Yeah, I too think that we go with what we have now as the regular meetings, the first and third Tuesdays, and at that time, if it seems like, oh, we really can't take this time off, we got to meet, we can schedule a special meeting then.
Okay.
So I'll move approval of this calendar.
In its current form?
Yeah.
Well, in its current
form,
with it would
include indication that the plan is to have a special meeting on the 11th rather than the 6th, and that we add the 20th as a regular meeting
and remove the 25th.
And
wait, I'm sorry, add what as a regular meeting?
Just the June 20th.
That's already, I'm sorry, so that is already scheduled.
Okay.
It's just that I forgot to include it in the calendar.
Mm-hmm. All right.
So what I have is,
when you guys schedule this room, is there a time frame of how far out you can schedule it?
That would be a question that I would have to get more information on. I know that I've scheduled the first and third Tuesdays of the foreseeable future in this room.
So there's a potential, like, for formation if we pick a date and pick a time, and we might be able to schedule a room for an hour a day, some at a regular schedule.
Yes, in the short term, it's a little more confusing.
Yeah.
As we saw the other day when we tried to schedule something, and I was told that there was already something booked, so we weren't going to be able to use the room. But yeah, in the long term, I think that would be good. It would be a suggestion of mine that all committees consider that. A regular meeting calendar, because any committee meetings, at least to my knowledge from having sat in the committees, no committee adopted a regular committee meeting schedule, and given that the committees are Brown Act committees, they would need to do that. And so any future meetings that the committees have this week will be special meetings.
And just to confirm the motion that I have right now, it's move the approval of this calendar as shown in Attachment A, with the addition that there will be a special meeting to be scheduled for April 11th and a regular meeting on June 20th. Is that my correct understanding?
I think that George also struck the
next
one on
the 20th.
Yeah.
Great point.
I don't think it's necessary to include the 20th. That would that is just my own.
And then, George, I think you would intend it. I don't think you did in your motion, though, to strike the one on the 25th.
You know, I just left it in for now.
Yeah, but I would, since we're referring specifically to attachment A and that's not on attachment A, I think it's important to have language saying that that it would be added.
That's fine.
And that we were removing the 25th, right?
It's just kind of redundant, I guess.
Totally. Jonathan?
I just wanted to that SBCC's summer break starts on the 13th, just to make note of since UCSB spring breaks in there.
Summer break?
We go out for summer on the 13th of May because we're semester
system. No way.
UCSB and SBCC spring breaks coincide though, right?
Yeah, same week.
Okay,
yeah,
good. So that's another one of the reasons I didn't even bother putting in the summer breaks, because that was just going to get too messy. There would have been too many blocked off days.
Well, I'm not saying we shouldn't meet because of that, just so you know.
Yeah, no, thank you for that.
Thank you.
Put in my last revision date.
So my understanding right now is just adding in that language at the end, move the approval of this calendar as shown in attachment A, with the addition that there will be a special meeting to be scheduled for April 11th and a regular meeting on June 20th, with the removal of the April 6th special meeting date. The 25th. Removing it?
Yeah, we were going to remove that one.
So with the removal of the April 6th and May 25th meeting dates.
Is that friendly with the first?
Yeah.
And second?
There's no second.
No second's been made.
Yep.
Someone wants a second?
I second it.
So that's Thurlow, Hedges. Any other board discussion? Any other public comment? Okay, so the motion that we're about to vote on is to move the approval of this calendar as shown in attachment A, with the addition that there will be a special meeting to be scheduled for April 11th and a regular meeting on June 20th, with the removal of the April 6th and May 25th meeting dates. Any other board discussion on that?
May I clarify what, sorry, I don't mean to interrupt. This is under 3.3A, correct? Just I was wondering where this motion falls under our
yes.
agenda. Thank you.
And I appreciate, yes.
And I would also say, so the A's and B's that are within items are completely arbitrary. 3.3A is not like an actual thing, it's just 3.3. A is one of the actions that is proposed. B is another action that is proposed.
When the minutes are recorded, would it be recorded? It would be under 3.3, discussion
yes.
topic A, correct? So therefore, A is an arbitrary, it's a discussion item, and therefore the motions would fall underneath that subheading, correct?
Not necessarily.
That's why I'm doing it.
Okay.
And then
But one thing I will say though, I'll
clean it up.
Far as we've been going with this meeting, we haven't been assuming that these are arbitrary, because in our initial motions for adopting policies, that was with A. I've been assuming that everything on here is not arbitrary, but written as intended.
Okay. Well, I'll say that in making these, I was structuring off of the Board of Supervisors agendas, and it's arbitrary in there. When they have it.
What do you mean arbitrary? That word doesn't make sense to me.
That A and B are...
That's for their consent items, I think you're talking about. Where it says A, B, C, blah, blah. That's like if they...
In any item, there are...
There
generally, when you have... whether it's departmental or administrative, usually it's under departmental items, though. There are different... actions that are being taken, and they're, let's say, this suggested actions.
Yeah, but the board has to decide on which of those actions it's going to take. It doesn't
yes.
take all of them.
Yes, correct. Director Jordan?
I wanted clarification. It doesn't really matter.
Okay.
I don't think. Unless Policy Formation Committee would actually like to make a policy on this.
I think that'll be
something
we
can consider.
Certainly
Thanks.
Talk about. Awesome. Okay, any other questions, discussion on the motion at hand?
I was going to say one more thing, which is that just because there aren't any green bubbles for, say, July, August, September, and so on and so forth, doesn't mean there aren't regular meetings scheduled then. The board adopted a regular meeting schedule that included the first and third Tuesday of each month. That is just a regular meeting schedule. So just clarification so everyone knows.
Okay. Director Freeman?
Wait, are we still in this? Where's our status? Okay, then no.
Okay.
I'll raise my hand
then. Yeah. Okay, so motion is to move the approval of this calendar as shown in Attachment A with the addition that there will be a special meeting to be scheduled for April 11th and a regular meeting on June 20th with the removal of the April 6th and the May 25th meeting dates.
Actually, I do have, okay, so this is just such a rat's, no concern about the motion of it, but it's such a rat's nest of this thing because this reminded me that the Board of Supervisors, due to the CEQA law, always tax on to every single motion that we would, for example, in this case, determine that these actions do not constitute a project under the California Environmental Quality Act pursuant to Section 15378B5 of the CEQA guidelines because they consist of administrative activities of government which will not result in direct or indirect physical changes in the environment.
I don't want to include that in my motion.
No, but that's a perfect example of what I was talking about. Where the sub thing.
Well, that's what I was trying to get the admin. They approve all that when they approve it, but in departmental they only. Anyways.
Call for the question, Chair.
Yeah. We are ready to do that. All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Any opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered, 7-0. Moving on, B, direct the Secretary of the Board to continue to work in consultation with the President of the Board to perform all duties necessary to schedule the meeting space in the community room for the requested meeting dates, post copies in public announcement spaces, and distribute the adopted schedule.
So moved.
Second.
Okay. Moved by Jordan, seconded by Thurlow.
It's the house one.
Yeah.
You gotta get on it.
Board discussion? Public comment? Seeing no public comment, I am calling the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered, 7-0. All right. That concludes section 3.4. Section 3.3. Since we've already done 3.4 now, moving on to 3.5, consider recommendations from the Formation Committee regarding online and electronic communications. I'd like to ask the chairperson of the Formation Committee to introduce us on this.
Oh, you want me to introduce us?
Or your designee, someone from the Formation Committee.
Let's see. So what happened at the Formation Committee meeting is we thought that this was an important item. We thought that all items that eventually get on to the, we should start a limited website, that the items that get on there should be approved by the full board so that anything additional that gets added to the site, the board kind of vets what that is. At the same time, we make sure when we do that vetting that we know that we can comply with these everything you need to know about online compliance. So if we did it one at a time or a few at a time, we can really take a look at this when we put the item on the agenda. And the ones we thought we should start with is, you know, posting the meeting agendas and minutes, the contact information and profiles of each director, a calendar of meetings, and the video and audio recordings of meetings and the committee meetings. And so then we decided to work with IVCDC to build that website. And I'm not sure what we mean by B, but directing the board president and secretary to bring an update, I guess, on how we're doing with the website. And then we also discussed about each individual director creating an email address specifically for district business. My original thought was get everybody be consistent, but we started off that nobody's really consistent. So there's a couple of good examples out there. Maybe people can say what their website is. You know, ebtrand. Did you use IVCSD?
Yeah, so yeah. ebertrand.ivcsd at Gmail.
Yeah.
Similar to Thurlow's.
Yeah. Wait, created a different spot. How do I do this?
Just create on Google a new email address for your CSD business, and then this is as much to protect your other emails that you keep all of your CSD business in that email.
So what are we calling it? Because you guys are kind of on the same page, so we can all kind of uniformly, people can find us.
Well,
what are we calling
right
it?
Now we're not too uniform, because I'm ebertrand.ivcsd at Gmail.
You're
just close.
.ivcsd, right, at Gmail.
Excellent.
And George, or?
George.thurlowcsd at Gmail.
So just
what's
something
yours?
With CSD?
And I didn't set mine up yet.
Everybody has CSD.
Yeah. Spencer's is kind of funky.
Oh, funky. Oh, no. Mine is just IVCSD at SpencerBrandt.com.
Kind of funky.
Oh,
yeah.
Is it?
Thanks, really uniform.
I like
everyone.
So I'm going to set up a Gmail account. I'll probably do rguys@ivcsd.com.
Well, you wouldn't be able to do that.
We don't have it. IVCSD.com.
I mean,
similar to mine, right?
I'm going
to
do it like
I'm
okay,
do something
okay.
And I'll email you from it.
Okay.
All of you. Right? Am I allowed to do that? Or is
yeah.
That
and the other thing is that, and I don't see Peggy here now, but during the formation committee proceedings, when we were a little concerned about the lack of uniformity, Peggy said, well, you know, I've got my email address up on the Park District website that's my district email, and it's not uniform with the other directors because directors come and go, and it's not a huge deal. So,
Director Freeman.
Yeah, weirdly, like the San Ynez Community Service District, the board members there don't have public email addresses, so you don't actually need to have, like, you don't have, they don't be consistent, much less exist, so
yeah.
I think we can have inconsistent email addresses.
Thank you, and going out to Gina for a moment.
For what it's worth, the county supervisors don't have consistent email addresses.
They don't. Yeah. Well, then,
all right, we should try eventually, then. Right, though? I feel like it'll be so much easier if everyone could just be like, first letter of the first name, last name, at, you know?
Yeah.
We should throw that to the policy committee to make a policy
yeah.
about future emails that directors create for district business.
But one more thing that I'll say before calling on Director Freeman. I believe on the Park District website and on many websites, you click on a person's name and a hyperlink and it leads to their email.
Yeah.
So
okay,
whatever the address is behind there, it'll probably be okay. Director Freeman?
Yeah, I think it would be much more reasonable to consider this if once we have a domain name or infrastructure as far as like consistency as it currently stands. I mean, it would be I think it's weird if we were, for example, insist on something consistent and then say it's going to be all on some third party like gmail.com. And then you can imagine a horrible case scenario where we get a new board member and their email address is already taken by somebody, and then like you can't even have a consistency. It's like I feel, but when we have a domain name, then I think we can reopen that.
Okay.
Yeah, and this is something that we discussed in the formation committee. The one concern was that we don't want to have people just going over and starting over with the email address. So I have my email address, George has his, Ethan has his. We don't want to make all of us scrap those emails and then go start over, because it's just kind of a difficult transition.
Yeah. So I'll move adoption of 3.5 A, B, and C.
Okay. I'll second.
Beat me to it.
wait a second. I have a lot more discussion on this.
That's fine.
You can
I'm
just
okay.
get,
I'm
yeah,
just getting a motion
can.
On there.
All
so
right,
we
that's
can
fine.
Start
okay.
discussing it.
Okay.
Wait, hold on. Still getting the motion.
Okay,
A, B, and C. I'd like to
recommend. Thurlow and Geis, right?
Yes.
Thurlow, Geis.
So, and also while you're doing that, if you don't mind, for members of the public who are interested regarding website and the compliance that Bob was speaking about, I left documents over there on the table called Everything You Need to Know About Compliance from the California Special District Association. This is something that was a board document for the formation committee meeting that was held, and it contains some of the statutes that we're going to have to be in compliance with when there's a district website.
One point in regard to the motion, could it be Would it be friendly with the first and second move to adopt the recommendations of the formation committee as found in 3.5 A, B, and C?
Sure.
Any other board comment on this motion, Jay?
Well, I want to comment on the motion. I have comments on, I mean, I sort of have a comment on the motion. Like, I want to continue discussing these other items other than the email address. So I want to actually discuss, for example, the direct the board president, board secretary, working representatives, IVCSD to build a website section of this.
The motion includes that.
Yeah, so then please speak on the motion. Okay, all right. So a few things that I have on this, one of which is that there was some conversation about like a domain name usage, and so they at the last meeting, Josh Plotke specified that he owned IlaVistaCSD.com.
I own.
Now Jonathan owns IlaVistaCSD.com. Great. Okay. So .com represents typically a commercial thing. I would recommend first of all doing the .org. I will state that I purchased .net and .org as soon as I heard a public mention of a domain name, because I was like, oh no, what if somebody else steals this domain name? And I'd be happy to provide those to Jonathan or whoever is directed by the board for you to provide them to. I will just give them to. But additionally, I've done some research, and it seems like it would not be very difficult for us at all in order to obtain
a...
It doesn't look like it would be very difficult for at all for us to obtain ivcsd.ca.gov. And the process for doing that apparently is just a matter of sending the... it's just a matter of sending the formation documents of our district to the California Secretary of the Internet or whatever, and then they will actually allocate that domain name. When I was going around and I didn't even bring this item up, I was just handing people agendas, people started pointing at that and then asking questions about the domain name, and then somebody asked about
it. I'll accept that as a friendly amendment, that we direct the secretary of the board to, and I totally agree that we should have a .gov.
Yeah.
I agree.
So can we direct this as an amendment to this, direct the secretary of the board to apply for a .gov domain name?
Yeah, it would be a dot. So there actually are two options. We actually possibly can, at the federal level, obtain a .gov. That may in fact may have to end up being like IlaVistaCSD.gov. The complexity for that seemed higher. The CA.gov was very easy, as far as being able to local government. But the .gov is actually like an option for us.
So I was surprised. Lovely.
So perhaps
IVCSD.ca.gov.
Yeah, the rules allow you to abbreviate non-common various things, and it looked like we'd be able to just abbreviate the whole thing in this case, and so you get IVCSD.ca.gov.
And there's no at in it?
There's no
at.
This is for the website,
But the thing is that this is for DNS, and so we actually then could have email addresses at ivcsd.ca.gov.
Awesome.
Cool. Okay. So then what I have here is move to adopt the recommendations of the formation committee as found in 3.5 A, B, and C, and to direct the secretary of the board to apply for a .gov domain name.
Was this ever seconded?
Yeah. Yes. Thurlow.
Got it.
Was the second?
I'm the second. And I
guys
is
no,
approve the amendment.
No, because this
was
is
not
my motion.
Yeah.
It's Thurlow.
It's Thurlow, guys.
Thank you.
That's why I'm the clerk.
As found on your name tag. Director Freeman.
Okay, and then I would like to make a statement about something which is important here. That so video and audio recordings of meetings and committee meetings. Our meetings are currently being recorded by me acting as a private citizen. I provide them under a license that would allow anyone to use them for any purpose, CC0, public domain. The district can use them, like that's as close as you get for public domain as is possible under U.S. copyright law. The district can use them and put them on their website. But I just want to make it clear that I am not currently acting under board direction recording or publicizing those. So I'm not taking on the compliance challenges right now of doing that for this district. And the way that this works under the law currently is that I am allowed to, for example, attend committee meetings, and the law states any person, not even any member of the public, any person attending a meeting is allowed to record using any form of audio, video, camera equipment, etc., the meeting. as long as they are not causing a persistent disruption that would actually be required to be determined by the board as a persistent disruption. And it even defines what forms of disruptions are applicable disruptions. I just bring this up because when I've looked into it, the closed captioning requirements are fairly onerous for this, and I am not prepared to take on the task of closed captioning all these videos. And I would actually warn the district about whether we are or not. So I'm wondering if we do this and we now put those video recordings on our website, are we prepared to do that? To be 100% clear on this, some people might think, oh, maybe Jay is saying this because he's hoarding these videos. I'm not. They're under CC0. Anyone can use them for any purpose whatsoever, including this district can utilize them. And I will provide the raw audio and video files to anyone who wants these things. But I am doing that as me. I'm not doing that as the board.
So for a clarification, in this motion, it's just more of a recommendation to, like, basically look more into it. It's not like we're actually going to be adopting any policy on it, correct?
No, this is directing the board president and board secretary to work with representatives from IVCSD to build a website for the IVCSD. Yeah.
That included a section to post up video and audio recordings of meetings and committee meetings, but listening to Jay make his explanation, I'm not so sure if it's good or if it has a downside.
Well,
Director Brandt,
I would have a question first, because I'm not entirely certain that there's a requirement for us to close caption videos that we post on our website. I know that when I watch County Board of Supervisors hearings, there is no closed caption. So I don't know. I think that maybe this is something that needs to be looked into further.
Can I ask that the board chair direct the policy committee to explore the idea of putting these videos on the website, but also explore the idea of having one board member acting as a member of the public. It's an awkward situation.
Right. And should that be separate from this motion?
Yes.
Okay, let's explore it.
Yeah, let's have this motion taken care of, and then we'll have a second one, which would be let's send this to policy.
Yes, and real quick, I'd like to recommend one more thing to throw on there. After direct the secretary of the board to apply for .gov domain name and direct the secretary of the board to obtain any available and appropriate recordings of meetings. And with that, that is what we're doing there, is directing the secretary to obtain them, and if it's helpful to carry out the rest of what's being directed to do so. Is that something that's friendly with maker and second?
Yep.
Director Freeman.
I just want to respond and say to Spencer that, in fact, I just brought up a random planning commission meeting, and it is closed captioned. And I believe that they're actually required, because they also post them on television. They're required under FCC regulation in addition to government regulation to have closed captions.
Okay. Maybe it's just the live streams that don't have closed captions.
Okay.
That's
awesome. Will we look into it?
We'll look into it.
All right, Director Jordan.
Sorry, excuse me. When we look into it, can we just look into that as part of it? Because this is all obviously in the works. It's not like cement, right? This isn't going to be like a for sure thing. So do we need to remove number 4? Is that what's being discussed? Or can we continue with the motion? That's kind of where we're at.
I don't think we need to remove it, because ultimately Director Brandt and I wouldn't act in a way that violated the law if we knew so. So, and this also doesn't set an amount of time that all this needs to be done in. So unless that's added, I think this is all discretionary, as long as we're putting a good faith effort into carrying it out.
Can a motion move to public comment? Is that a motion?
If you don't want to move it, I'll go there.
Okay.
Cool. Any public comment? Ash?
Yeah, when you say to apply for a .gov address, do you want to specify it as ca.gov address or not?
Well, if you want, I can look into the other one too.
Is .gov all-encompassing?
Yeah.
Let me see. You can apply for a federal, just IVCSD.gov, or a state level.
I would say if it's friendly, change it to ca.gov.
Perhaps direct the secretary of the board to apply for the appropriate .gov domain name?
Yeah.
Sounds good. Is that something that...
Your question is, what are you going to do with your website now, Jonathan? What are we doing with our .com?
Oh, well, that's another thing.
I was kidding.
That's another thing I was going to say. Okay. Yeah. Never mind.
Any other public comment? Jonathan?
I don't know how extensively it's in the minutes. I didn't look at the formation minutes, but why IVCDC is doing is because there was the discussion of free labor. Someone who the district asks to do the website. So if a person does it, we can get into a complicated situation. But if a nonprofit does it, we're safer in terms of what we owe and all that. So that's why IVCDC. We haven't voted on it as a board yet, but I don't imagine it being a problem. So I do want to let you know that our board has to still approve it. We were supposed to meet on Sunday, but we couldn't. So we're figuring out our next meeting, probably this weekend. So we'll know before April 4th before we report back.
Cool.
Yeah, and my feeling on this is that we have heard interest from the IVCDC officers. If for some reason this isn't something that would be carried out, that'll be something we'll report back to the board at this next meeting.
That's right.
Awesome. Any other public comment? I think, Art, you had your hand?
Yeah, you limited the sites you're going to apply for. You should apply for all practical sites.
That should all applicable, I think, right?
Any appropriate was all what we had.
Any appropriate. Any appropriate website, so like .ca.gov, .gov. Is that good?
Yes.
Awesome, thank you.
Thank you. All right, so one more, I'll read it as we are have it now. Move to adopt the recommendations of the formation committee as found in 3.5 A, B, and C. Direct the Secretary of the Board to apply for the appropriate .gov domain name and direct the Secretary of the Board to obtain any available and appropriate recordings of meetings. Anything that directors would like to add?
That's singular. You want plural. Appropriate names, not appropriate name.
Thank you. You're right.
No, we only want one eventually.
Let's do the...
You want to apply for one?
You just put the parentheses around the mess.
Sure. Is that friendly with the maker and the second?
Yes.
Okay. Great. Thank you. It's in there now. Any other board comment? No more public comment? Seeing none, calling the question. All those in favor?
Aye.
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 All those opposed? Any abstentions? So ordered. All right. Is there any other discussion within item 3.5?
I want to move to direct the policy, the chair, board chair, to direct the policy committee to discuss policies regarding video recordings.
And I'll second.
So move to direct the policy committee to discuss policies regarding video recordings?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
All right.
Director Freeman?
This actually is relevant to bothering to move to put it in the policy committee. The way the Brown Act is written and the way that we cannot violate the mechanisms of the Brown Act, I'm not certain what policies are even allowed to put on video recording. We're not allowed to limit it, for example. The law literally says any person attending an open and public meeting of a legislative body or a local agency shall have the right to record the proceedings with an audio or video recorder or a still or motion picture camera in the absence of a reasonable finding by the legislative body of the local agency, so it would have to be the board, that the recording cannot continue without noise, illumination, or obstruction of view that constitutes or would constitute a persistent disruption of the proceedings.
Yeah.
So. The reason I'm bringing this up in this motion is that I believe that it is actually a waste of our time to put it on the policy agenda.
Point of clarification from the maker, you're referring to our internal policy for publishing videos, right? Not about the members and the public recording.
Well, here's the rub here that I see, which is we have a member of our board who's not acting as a member of the public. He's acting as a member of the board in recording these meetings, and you can't separate it. I mean, you can't say, well, I'm a member of the public recording these meetings. What I'd like to get is some clarification about a member of the board recording the meetings as a board member. versus a member of the public recording the meetings for purposes of public.
But that's not a policy
yeah,
issue.
Yeah, I don't think that would be in the jurisdiction of policy
okay.
committee.
And for example, then, I mean, like, I could just not publish those meetings publicly, and then I'm very confident that everyone is satisfied with this. Otherwise, it would essentially be like a legal issue you could take up with me, I could take up with you, and I actually will get legal counsel over this one.
Okay.
Are you still looking for a second?
No, sorry. I'll withdraw my motion.
Okay, motion withdrawn. Any other comment on item 3.5? Okay, seeing none, moving on to item 3.6. Consider recommendation regarding an internship program. The board will receive a report from the internship committee, discuss the development of an internship committee, and consider taking action on a proposed memorandum of understanding, see attachment J. The board may also consider action on the structure and operations of the committee. So I'll start off just a little recap of our meeting the other day. One moment, please. So we met on Friday afternoon. It was a well-attended meeting. We had many students there, which was very interesting to see. I imagine some students who are interested in potentially applying for the program. And we discussed the items on our agenda. There were a few items that we didn't make decisions on. Starting at the beginning, we didn't elect a chair of the committee because we only had two members present, myself and Director Thurlow. Director Jordan couldn't attend, but both of us actually felt that Director Thurlow would make a great, Director Jordan would make a great chair. And that's something that will be great to discuss at a future internship committee meeting. But that was our reasoning for not taking.
You don't show up.
Oh, thanks, guys.
You change your grade from a C to an A if you take it.
But, we didn't take any action there. As far as overview, goal setting, and mission statement, our mission statement is to establish an internship program, work with partnering stakeholders to determine a structure to administer the program, and create metrics in order to evaluate the success of an internship program. So right now, the mission that we came up with didn't specify actually managing a future internship program, but just designing it and working with the necessary entities to do so. And we discussed different attributes of an internship program that would be great, but no action was taken on that. We also discussed the draft memorandum of understanding that's attached in this agenda for the board meeting. Also, no action taken. So really the only action that was taken at the meeting was setting a mission statement. And we don't have a future meeting date yet, which will be solidified upon finding a date that the three of us can be together for.
But my understanding was we didn't take action because we only had two members of the committee.
So can we take action now?
So,
no. Well, not.
Because we're in big directors? I don't know.
We can take action as the board, not as the committee.
Yeah,
exactly.
That's what I'm saying.
That's what I meant.
Yeah.
So my understanding was we were going to put this in front of the board for action tonight.
Oh, on the MOU, correct?
Yes.
Yes, and that's how we have it agendized. But I meant we didn't take action on any of these because we didn't feel the need to do that in committee, but rather refer it back to the board of directors. So with that said, if you have anything, if you want to introduce this, that would actually be
well.
Great.
Let me say that Political Science Department is very interested in partnering with the CSD to create an internship program with funding that would come from two sources for the spring quarter, a private donor, and we have their money in hand, and a pledge from the Associated Students for $3,000. And that money has yet to be authorized, but there's an anticipation that it will come.
Oh, it was approved.
Well, apparently there's some technicality that it has to come back. But anyway, we're going to spend it as though it's been approved. So the money will flow into the Alumni Affairs Office and be distributed to students that are selected by the poli-sci department. As a result of our discussion, there is interest from other entities, including nonprofits, to set up their own internship programs. And I think that's great, and it wouldn't be through this MOU. It'd be through separate MOUs. So this MOU simply covers the poli-sci department with the idea that this would be a beta test, see what happens. Either two or four interns would be selected by poli-sci. They'd be assigned to the board for work in the spring quarter, and everybody's ready to go as soon as the MOU is agreed to for the first day of classes.
Woohoo! That's great.
Spring quarter.
What's the first day of class?
April 3rd.
Oops, April 3rd is the first day of class.
April 3rd.
Which is like next
so,
week.
Yeah.
So for the 2 to 4 people, do we have what their, will the program be developed with them? Is that how it works?
I think the idea is to get them going right now for spring quarter, because they need to know and poli-sci needs to know. Otherwise, we wait till summer.
Yeah.
And then the whole reason we're pushing this is if we waited till summer, things will fall apart, and it'll be fall before we have another. Versus, if this works out really well, by the middle of spring quarter, we can start working on summer. We can probably get funding. And, you know, I'm optimistic that this would be a project that the university would be interested in funding.
Awesome.
And just to clarify, so these interns would be employees of the university.
Correct.
That the board of directors would, upon approval of this, be authorized to coordinate with. Or?
Yeah, according to the MOU, and I don't have the language right in front of me, but essentially the poli-sci department will determine the academic piece to this, and the CSD will determine the work project status. And I will try to be incredibly careful not to in any way influence what the project status is. All we're going to do is Susan is going to handle what is a real pain, which is getting the students onto payroll and off of payroll. And the biggest pain, getting them to turn their time cards in.
Right. And what I just wanted to clarify by that is we are not discussing bringing on any employees of the community services district,
no,
but rather
all the employees of the university. Correct.
Thank you for that clarification.
Any questions thus far? Director Freeman?
Okay, so first of all, some context for any questions I provide is that I have been part-time faculty now at the university for many years. I have been kind of weirdly, unofficially in some cases, like involved in some of the university politics. At one point, I was on a dean search committee, so I've been dealing with the university a lot over the course of the last 17 or 18 years. When this came up, and also sometimes I think people sometimes very incorrectly get an impression that I somehow don't like the university. I occasionally hear rumors about this. I love the university. I'm a Lancaster fellow. I've donated over $100,000 to the university. So when this came up, I ended up going and I talked to poli-sci in order to get an impression of what was going on as far as in their minds about constructing something like this. I was very excited to actually get to see the MOU. I have spoken with various groups that I know of on campus that run internship programs in order to compare and contrast our internship program with other internship programs. I have delved somewhat into some of the administration hurdles and complexities with relation to constructing an internship program, and so I've got some various questions about this. One of which is that I'm curious to know, and I think I'm expecting a good answer here, how the liability for these people will end up working out. Like, let's say that we end up directing them to do something, and then they go off, and on the way to doing that, they get into a car accident, or they trip and fall, or something like that. Will the liability with that be taken by the university because they are hiring these people, or is it going to be us?
It's whatever the law is.
Okay.
And I'm not an attorney, and so I would tell you, I do know enough to know that if you send an intern in a car to a task and they are injured, your workers' compensation will kick in.
Right.
And that's a real, real problem.
And part of the
That goes back to that goes back to why insurance for this board is absolutely critical. But they're essentially, we have interns all over the world doing everything from, you know, as you know, diving, deep diving to climbing mountains, and there's always an issue of are they employees of the university? These will be employees of the university.
Meaning that presumably that potential workers' comp claim would be a university.
Well, we don't have workers' comp insurance, so it would be up against the university, yes.
Right.
Especially if they're not, like, if you think about it, they wouldn't be, like, signing any liability waivers with us, and we wouldn't even have their information. Like, we wouldn't be able to hold their social security number or anything else. So if they were to file a private claim against us as, like, either a worker, that would make sense. But I don't think that, like, under the purview of them being an intern underneath the CSD, they would have any true claim.
It raises a very interesting question, because if somebody on this board were to sexually harass an intern, then there's liability.
That does make sense. Maybe you should seek legal counsel. Can we do that?
George, I heard that you guys have.
Well, actually, before, I know Director Freeman still had.
I have other comments, but it sounds like we're now talking about this.
Sorry.
Okay.
I was just going to talk about the liability. I heard that the university does have some language when they execute agreements, like between the county and the university, at the mutually hold harmless exclusions. That is standard language that the university uses that gives that a little bit of protection to the IVCSD.
Right.
So I don't know if you can.
The
risk manager at the county said he could help me if I needed it.
Well, the regents of the university insist that in any contract they have with somebody, they're held harmless.
Right.
And it holds up contracts
forever.
And I can tell you that even contracts that would bring millions of dollars to the university get held up because the university insists on being indemnified against any. I mean, I think the thing about this is the poli-sci department, and this is alumni affairs taking on all the risk here. And if there's a problem, if there's something bad happens, we're gonna, the poli-sci. But this is really no different than other internship programs, some of which are way more complicated. But the idea here is we wanted to get something going for the spring, and the poli-sci department was ready and willing and wanted to jump on it, and that's why it's not SOCIA or anything else. But if I really worry that if we don't do this now, it will be next fall, and we won't have interns.
Go ahead, Jay. Floor is yours, Jay.
Go ahead, Jen. Just jump in.
I think also something that I would like the board to keep in mind is that in a way this is our first contract negotiation. This is us talking with the university about a contract with various terms and clauses. And so like Bob's comment about maybe we would want to look into some kind of indemnification language, which, by the way, I also know the university just never does, but is the kind of thing that I would like to see us do while we are discussing this MOU. Is if there are things that we want, we should push on George a little bit and try to see if we can get George to not be 100% happy at the end of this, because none of us should end up being 100% happy at the end of this. So on that note, other things that I would poke at, on that note, I would like to then ask George a high-level question is how locked in do you think this is going to be? Like, when we make this, what is the complexity on your end as far as trying to get this through various forms of administration? Like,
it's a one-quarter deal.
Okay, so it says start date. Program will continue through the summer months. So we're going to stop.
But we don't have money for it. We don't have money right now.
Yeah.
We have only money for one quarter.
Okay.
So
I just want to verify then that this is actually will terminate at the end of the summer months, and then we will negotiate a new MOU for what's going on in fall.
If you want. Sure.
Well,
also, I feel like that's something that would be under the purview of the internship committee to renegotiate.
Yeah. What is it that you want that you're not getting? If you want to take care of the time cards, I'd be really thrilled if you know, we could have a committee take care of the time cards, the, as you know, the entrance and exit paperwork to be a university employee is quite burdensome. So I'm happy. So it's not like we got all the good, I got all the good stuff. In fact, let me tell you, personally, there's nothing here that benefits me or alumni affairs. Nothing.
And my thought also, just in addition to this, I'm sorry.
No problem. No, I was just gonna call him.
I just was thinking that, like, this, I understand this is our first contract, but today is the 21st, which means that we have less than 2 weeks to have this not only implemented, but the selection of the students and also have them put into place. And for me, like when I plan out my quarter, I really like to have things set into place. So I think that by us stalling this, it's not only not fair to the university, but it's not fair to the students who would be put in this position. And I, at this point, I feel like we need all the help we can get, but that's kind of where I'm at with it.
Well, so a key point that I would make as far as fairness to the students, and this is something that I feel is currently missing in some of this, is as it currently stands, I have not heard in any of the things that have come around this, or even like so the 90-day action plan, which was provided at least, that had some, which we did not end up discussing that agenda, that actually had some background as far as what the interns could expect to do. But for example, the email that was sent by PoliSci to students didn't actually specify what they would do. As an advocate sometimes for students, I would point out that as it currently stands, let's say that we bring on a student. Are we guaranteeing them any number of hours on this program? Do we have any structure by which they will know before they end up in our program in like a week and a half that of what they expect to actually be working on? I'm somewhat concerned about the idea that we're going to be, in a way, I mean, it's indirect to the university. And I actually am very thankful, George, that you've, I'm impressed, actually, at the way in which you've managed to wear various hats and pull this off. But that's one of the cool things about working with you on this. But it's
a startup, Jay.
Yeah.
It's a startup, and that's how we need to think up here. Mm-hmm. This is a startup. There's not going to be a lot of rules of the road. We're going to have to implement as we go along. We're going to have to invent things as we go along, and we're going to have to take advantage of opportunities and I agree with you. If this fails, look, there's not a whole lot of people that are going to get blamed for it failing. And if it's widely successful, we'll have everybody on this board sharing in the success. I think we need to think outside the box, and this was totally thinking outside the box. And I don't want to say anything more about the MOU.
Sure. Director Jordan?
I motion to approve the MOU as it stands.
I would ask that you direct the board president to sign the MOU on behalf of the board, so there's a signature.
So moved.
I second that.
Thank you.
Okay, so what I have right now is motion made by Jordan, seconded by Hedges. Move to approve the MOU as it stands and direct the board president to sign the MOU on behalf of the IVCSD Board of Directors.
And where do we send it to, George?
Well, do I have a correct understanding of the motion that's been made and seconded?
It will be sent to PoliSci.
And addressed to the Political Science Department.
Yes. Because this is really where the policy is.
You think you can have that in there, please?
Sure.
And send to the Political Science Department. Who, Dr. Keller?
The chair of the department is Beattie.
Beattie,
yeah. It should go to him.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, so
what I have now is move to approve the MOU as it stands and direct the board president to sign the MOU on behalf of the IVCSD Board of Directors and send the MOU to the chair of the Department of Political Science. That's as made and seconded. Director Freeman.
I'm actually a little bit annoyed at this point that I was not able to get any clarification that the intent of the wording, the program will continue through the summer months, is that this contract will terminate. This to me seems like a contract termination clauses seem to be like very important as far as when we're going to enter into an agreement. And if George is unwilling to answer that, I'm actually hurt.
Well, no, I did answer it. I said we only have funding through the end of the spring.
That is
quarter.
Not an answer to the question of whether this contract terminates at the end of the summer. If you
I'm
want
not
to say
a lawyer.
The contract terminates at the end of the
I'm
spring,
not a lawyer. I'm not licensed to practice law in California. I'm sorry. I don't know if that language, which you're interpreting as a contract, I don't know that. I'm not a lawyer.
But you are the negotiator. I'm asking for the intent behind it. That's what you do when you're negotiating.
The intent was that because of the university and the way it operates, I wanted to bundle the spring with the summer.
Okay.
And therefore get some momentum going so that we don't have to try and reinvent this whole thing for the summer months, and instead reinvent it in the fall.
But we do get to reinvent it in the fall, because if not, then I'm good. Oh. Then we actually do have issues more that we need to talk
about.
Director Freeman, would you like to move to amend the motion?
If you want to move to amend,
I would like to move to amend the motion in order to modify the MOU in order to state that the contract.
Wait here,
this
but
MOU
let's take it slower so okay. It can be recorded. move to amend the motion
to state that the memorandum of understanding in point 8 states that this memorandum of understanding will terminate at the beginning of fall quarter for UCSB. That's a good idea. Fall quarter 2017 of UCSB.
Okay, so we now have the secondary motion made to amend. Okay, I'm going to read the secondary motion though. Move to amend the motion to state that the memorandum of understanding in point 8 states that this MOU will terminate at the beginning of fall quarter 2017 of UCSB. Did you mean to say, for simpler terms, in point 8 of the memorandum of understanding?
In point 8 of the memorandum of understanding, that's fine. I'm friendly with that.
Okay, so that's the secondary motion that's made. Is there, it's not friendly, right?
It's not friendly with the first.
Okay, it's
because
not.
Because, I reserve my right. The whole idea of having a negotiation that would be that both sides need to be present in making a deal, and so us changing the intent of the motion, which when you actually make a motion and you amend it, it should not actually change the core value of the motion. That's actually a retroactive motion. It shouldn't, those amendments actually contradict it, so you're supposed to vote on it and make a new motion, but that's just a separate issue. The whole point of a negotiation is that both sides should be present and actively engaged, and by us changing the intent of the MOU and sending it back to them with our interpretation isn't a negotiation, that's us telling them what to do. So I think we should either take it as it stands or kill it. So you can either do that with my motion and then make up your own, but I prefer if my motion stays as it stands.
Okay. Being that we did adopt these new rules, is there anyone who would like to second the secondary motion that's been made? No one would like to second the motion? Okay, the secondary motion fails. The motion remains as is unless anyone else has any other secondary motions. Director Freeman.
Okay, in that case, I'm going to point out that if we somehow believe that this contract is not designed to terminate at the end of summer quarter, which is how I'm going to interpret Director Jordan's comments, I am going to then state that we need to seriously consider the interns will be paid $12 an hour clause because of California minimum wage law increases. We should at least be trying to figure out how to comply that with the California calendar. And separately, by the way, I will point out that there are internships on campus that pay $14 an hour. We should at least have a discussion about whether we, as a board, agree that $12 an hour is the correct amount. Partly because of the fact that, because of the academic component, the effective wage of the people who will actually be working on this will actually be much lower because we cannot pay people for academic work. And it actually will probably require two separate job descriptions in order to try to bring people in under this, but it will be fairly complex, and in the end, we might end up effectively only be paying people $6 an hour.
Director Jordan.
Okay. I totally feel where you're coming from, and I get that, but like none of us are in a position to negotiate because we're not talking against anyone else, do you know what I'm saying? So we're just like, you know, there's no one to like respond to this, like as a university representative from the political science department to discuss this. And seeing as we don't hire them and we don't directly pay with them, their payment has like almost nothing to do with us, in my opinion. Because it also the hiring documentation and everything is gonna be handled by the OSAIV. So all of that
will
be.
George.
I know it's George, but like we're not talking about it as George, the board of directors, we're talking about it as the OSAIV. Do you get what I'm saying? The separation there? So I just think that we're not in a position to be negotiating over an MOU that just clearly needs to be implemented within a time period. And if you don't like my motion, then just kill it. But I think we should still vote on it.
Director Geis.
I just read this last sentence and it just says the program will continue through the summer months. To me, after that, it ends and it's subject to, then it opens it up that we have to change number 8 to continue the memorandum, and it opens it up, and it's subject to negotiation again. So I think the intent here is that's where they got spending to get it through the summer months, and then, you know, I'm sure we're all going to love the program, and we're going to want to continue it, and hopefully we all love the program and get good work done.
Can we call a question, please?
Yes. Well, if you would like to make a motion for that, I still have more questions. But if you would like to make
if you have more questions, I understand that. I'm talking more specifically about like my motion. If we're having a larger discussion about the memorandum of understanding, like, that's fine. But like when we're in a motion, so I figured the discussion would be on my motion itself,
yeah.
Not the actual.
Well, your motion is to move to approve the MOU as written. So I think we can discuss as it's written.
Okay.
Though I'm very favorable of this MOU. I have a few more questions, but you still have the right to move to call it. Okay. Number 5, just one thing I highlighted, the last sentence, problems or disputes between student interns and their internship supervisor will be resolved by the OSAIV. What I'm getting from this, the internship supervisor is not the CSD. Is that correct?
Correct. No, my understanding is internship supervisor, as it's stated here, is the CSD.
As stated where? The top part, the project work will be assigned?
Yes.
Where do you see that?
And actually, that was put in because the poli-sci department did not want to be in the middle of disputes.
Fair. Does anyone else have concern with the ambiguity of that internship supervisor, and is that something that's maybe?
If you want to strike that, that just makes my job easier.
So, again, if they specifically asked to put it in there, then
no. They originally we had an academic component to problems, and they didn't want to get pulled into problems about, you know.
Okay.
My supervisor told me.
So you put this here in place in lieu of that.
Yeah. Okay. And I'm happy to strike it. If there's problems with it, I'm happy to strike it.
Well, I think it's a good thing to have. I was just more concerned about who the internship supervisor is, but perhaps that's something that's figured out.
Well, there's going to be the academic component, and then there's going to be the work component. And I would assume that somebody is going to tell them what to do.
And that'll be determined by an action of this board in the future.
Exactly.
Okay. That was my question.
It'll have to be done pretty soon though, right?
So then perhaps that's a motion after this one, but I just wanted to.
I mean, one of the things you can have the internship committee do in its next meeting is to discuss immediate tasks for interns that are starting on April 3rd. And I would assume there's everything from .gov to taking the minutes of meetings.
Yes, please.
Okay, item. So we haven't gone out to the public on this yet. I'd now like to ask if there's any public comment on the motion at hand to approve the MOU as it stands and direct me to write on it. Ben?
I just have a couple of questions. So earlier it seemed like you guys were saying that there's not enough funding to cover the summer quarter, and that right now there's currently only funding to cover a spring. Is that correct?
That's correct.
So I guess my comment would be, it seems slightly unfair. Like, as a student, the internship sounds great. It's just, if I'm only getting paid, if I'm promised a paid internship, and I'm only going to get paid for half of it, or I only know I'm going to get paid for half of it, I don't know that I would.
Interns accepted for both quarters.
Right.
The interns are accepted on a quarterly basis. So you'd be accepted right now, and then when your class term ends, which would be June 16th, that's when also this internship would expire. So it's a one quarter long internship, so it's not like you're gonna get gypped for the second half.
Okay.
Entering into this MOU doesn't make any promises with any students. Those promises would be made upon the signing of, upon becoming employed, correct? Mm-hmm.
George, are there efforts underway to attain funding for the summer portion of the internship program?
Sure.
Okay.
Art,
for the record.
Sure. Just the other thing is, the money coming from AS, is that separate from the $200,000 that it's supposed to be allocated from the university?
The 200?
Yes.
AS is a separate entity. Any other public comments? Darcel, did you? Well, did you have a comment?
No.
Okay.
Art. I mean, I have.
You might want to address Jay's questions by having the committee make a proposal in the committee, separate from the MOU. So the committee's going to say, all right, we're going to do this many hours, so the applying student can have some idea of the extent of it, not just the time extent, but the work extent, maybe.
Good point. Shomit?
Yeah, hi. I'm asking this question for clarity for a story I'll be doing for the bottom line. Will students need to be majoring in political science in order to be eligible to become an intern?
I don't think that's defined in this memorandum of understanding.
That's a great question. It's up to the poli sci department.
Mm-hmm.
It's really our intent. The intent is that this be opened up to all majors. And the intent is that if this is successful, we're going to expand this program to sociology and history and potentially the art department.
So the process of hiring these interns is not a component of the MOU at all?
The MOU, I think, states that the poli sci department will set the guidelines for hiring these students.
Yes. In the second sentence of section 3, it says the interns will be selected by the Department of Political Science after consultation with the IVCSD.
Yeah, so that would entail applications and such.
Did you get the email?
I did not.
Okay. There's an email that went out from the poli sci department like 3 weeks ago.
To the email?
To all the emails. And one of those like OSL email blast things.
Okay.
If you want, I think there might be a little bit more info on there, like from what they said.
From if it's the email I saw, it was very brief and just said kind of stay tuned, but there may have been one that followed.
And essentially I told them to wait until until the board had acted, because it would be presumptuous for them to imply that there was an agreement before there was such an agreement.
Right. Okay. Any other public comment? More board discussion on this. No more board discussion. All right, I see a hand in the public. Ben?
I was just thinking, Director Freeman has a lot of kind of issues, maybe the internship committee should try to get someone from the poli sci department as well, just to kind of see if maybe that would help answer some questions. I mean, I know Director Thurlow kind of fills that role, but
it's a good idea.
Excellent idea. Director Freeman?
I can actually tell you very explicitly that my questions cannot be answered by political science, because I have had over an hour's worth of multiple meetings with political science in order to get any questions I would have had with political science answered. All my questions now are just with George.
Fair enough.
One of the great benefits of having George on this committee, on this board, I hear, is that we will be able to actually have the knowledge of the university and be able to negotiate with them directly.
Okay, is there any more board discussion on this motion? Any more public discussion? I'm ready to call this question. Okay, I'm just gonna read it one more time. Move to approve the MOU as it stands and direct the board president to sign the MOU on behalf of the IVCSD Board of Directors and send the MOU to the chair of the Department of Political Science. And is it friendly with the maker and second if, rather than as it stands, have as written?
Sure.
Yes.
Second. Okay. Move to approve the MOU as written and direct the board president to sign the MOU on behalf of the IVCSD Board of Directors and send the MOU to the chair of the Department of Political Science. Public comment on that last part? None. Board comment? Okay.
Call the roll.
Secretary Brandt, if you could do a roll call vote.
Director Bertrand.
Aye.
Director Jordan.
Aye.
Director Brandt, I say aye. Director Freeman.
Abstain.
Director Hedges.
Aye.
Director Geis.
Aye.
Director Thurlow.
Abstain.
Motion passes 5-0. Two abstentions. Freeman, Thurlow.
Awesome.
So ordered. All right. Is there any other discussion within this agenda item? We've passed that long anticipated motion. Jay.
Yeah. Actually, wait a second. I didn't read the agenda. Report to internship committee. Discuss development of an internship program. Okay. So another conversation that I ended up having, quite incidentally, was with the somebody from the San Ynez Community Service District, who was excited about the possibility of paying interns. Like they would actually put forward funding in order to pay interns in order to have UCSB interns work with them. Now, one of the complexities that we have here is how are we going to deal with supervision and general kinds of like staffing and management issues? And I think it would be interesting to attempt to essentially coordinate with other nearby community services districts, because we have so many of them here in the third district, in order to try to expand the scope of an internship program such that, for example, from a learning perspective, you could actually rotate through, for example, some of the community service districts. And that would also give us resources that we could fall back on at these other community service districts in order to get help with the management supervision components. And it also, I think, would give us other kinds of inroads in order to get other forms of partnerships in these other community service districts in order to help us with these complex problems of how do we do anything. As far as I've been able to tell, political science would actually be happy to work on this. Their main concern issue is that if they have students who are just working, for example, for San Ynez, how do you send them over the hill? Because it's like when that 45-minute drive is an incredibly onerous thing. But that was an idea then, is if we were to, for example, have people rotating through various CSDs, or if there was more remote work that could be done for some of them. And then if we were to, for example, work with other academic institutions, PoliSci is already interested in some ways of talking. Like, they mentioned Westmont and as another option. I know there's also there's another college that's in.
There's
the
a 2-year college. Which
Santa Barbara.
SBCC, but they're even further away from San Ynez, and they're further away from all other community service districts, including I believe Kiama by drive.
We did specifically talk about SBCC. There's another one that's like further north. Alan Hancock. It'd be an interesting thing to try. And if we kind of figure out a way to coordinate a joint program between these entities, I think that it could actually just be extremely powerful and fun for everyone involved.
I think that sounds like something very interesting to explore in the future. I personally don't think that the internship committee would be ready to take that on now, but I mean, I think that sounds like an excellent idea to consider.
Awesome.
Jonathan.
Yeah, just off what you just said, and Jay, I don't think you were at internship committee, right? So I would just want to repeat something I said then. Kind of the way I was thinking about it was that the CSD has an internship program that UCSD right now is giving interns to, that presumably other organizations could give interns to the CSD internship program. So,
this is an expansion of scope in a different direction, which is to try to figure out new ways of giving people more variety of learning experiences, because I'm, again, putting on my student advocate hat, but then at the same time also figuring out ways of giving us ways of connecting with those other districts. Right. So.
Thank you. So my one thing that I think may be a second motion to make within this item is to direct the board president and perhaps the board secretary to work to develop the role. Well, actually, no, that should probably be the internship committee. But at this point, do we need any direction from the board of directors to authorize officers to coordinate with interns, or can that be done in a future meeting?
Internship committee.
Yeah. Well, the board of directors, the internship committee cannot direct any of us to do anything, unfortunately.
No, but we can set up the, we'll set up the structure. I think that.
But it would still have to be approved
and then send
by
it
the board.
To the, obviously.
Yes,
obviously.
But then
but
if this
for
is
the timeline.
Yeah, because if this is starting, April 1st is the first day, right, of spring quarter.
April 3rd.
April 3rd. Our next meeting isn't until
April 4th.
So we would have one day where there's no direction for those interns who may have been given work.
It'll take them that long to get through payroll.
That's right. Actually, it will take them that long to get through payroll.
Okay. So you're comfortable at this time proceeding with no direction?
No, we can make the start date. We can make the start date for the interns any day we want. In other words, their first day. The main thing we have to do, though, is we have to get this MOU agreed upon at this meeting.
Which we did.
Right. So what I would say is that the internship committee should try and work as much as it can to get a structure in place. We'll get them onboarded, is the word, through the process, which will take a day.
So at that April 4th meeting, we will
have a structure.
Okay.
You're really trying to identify projects for the interns to do at that April 4th meeting, right? That's what the MOU says. What are the projects going to be?
And perhaps I'm more, perhaps, yes, absolutely. Perhaps I'm more wondering if right now, because before my question was, who's the internship supervisor? At this point, did we want to designate officers of this board to fulfill that role? Or is that something
that's okay with me? Is it okay with the rest of the board? It's okay with me.
I don't think that board members should be supervising people.
Right.
Then they become your employees. I think the university has to supervise the people. I think we need to set the projects that they're going to work on.
That's a great
idea. Right. Didn't you just vote yes on the MOU said otherwise?
That's not how I say the actual project work will be assigned by the CSD with oversight by the university. I mean, these are university employees. That's how I read this MOU. And you don't want to get into a supervisory role as a board director supervising university employees. It just can't work that way.
Maybe I'm just confused on the language.
Because supervisor to me means supervisor.
Okay.
I'm going to direct you on how to come to work. I'm going to direct you what time to be there.
What about a coordinator? Because I don't know if the poli sci department is really going to be wanting to like schedule all that.
They are
stuff.
Not, as we just voted on.
Yeah, they don't want to do that. So somebody's got to do it. Somebody's got to call them.
So perhaps this is something, I mean, if you're comfortable that this will be decided the day after the program starts, we can direct this to the internship
committee. I think that's okay. I think we have the nimble, I think we're nimble. I think we can do it.
So do you have a motion?
I think you make a great point, but so let's see if the internship committee can address that point, as well as the points that Jay has brought up. I mean, I don't think there's any problem with us going back to the poli-sci department and have an amendment to this MOU that says we should pay them whatever the California prevailing wage is.
So this
but
does
I thought it was 12.
This is CSD for work.
Well, we already signed it. Like, it's going to go against our last motion,
yeah.
So we can't
right.
negotiate.
Right.
So we're already,
okay.
we've already
right.
dug our own grave. So.
All right.
Sorry. So I motion to move on.
Well, are we... Well, okay.
Yeah.
So,
I think the.
Is there a second?
Well, internship. Yes, to move on.
Yeah. Okay. Well, that's moved and seconded. But my question was there any direction to give to the internship committee?
I think the internship committee that's sitting up here has lots of direction. Yes.
Okay.
Maybe the internship committee could come back to the board on. You know, this is a little bit of a problematic paragraph about how this oversight and project work is going to be assigned and who's going to be the employee's real supervisor.
Well, but don't we always give a report? So, like, the other, every committee gives a report during the meeting, so next week when they give a report, we'll just plug that right in there, right?
But yeah. The report is a record of the proceedings of the committee.
So then
yeah.
We'll just talk about it in committee, because it just
yes.
came up right now.
But exactly. I think the committee needs direction from the board of directors.
I rescind my motion.
Okay.
I rescind it.
Would you like to make another motion?
I'd love to make another motion. I motion for the internship committee to discuss intern oversight and supervision, as well as other tasks and the negotiation of future contracts. Is there anything else I should throw in there? Taking suggestions.
Sink. My suggestion would be and everything else necessary for building a robust internship program.
Beautiful.
Beautiful.
Beautiful. Gorgeous. Beautiful language. Is there a second?
Robust.
Was there a second?
I'll second that.
Flavorful language.
Okay, so what we have, I move for the internship committee to discuss intern oversight and supervision, as well as other tasks, the negotiation of future contracts, and everything else necessary for building a robust internship program.
Okay.
And one amendment I'd like to recommend to discuss and develop recommendations
yeah.
for.
And report back. You can say report back as well if you want.
If you like
unless
all.
It's implied.
I think
okay.
it is. But
that's
I'm happy to.
It's implied.
From the second.
Friendly.
Okay.
And he's well insurance.
Yeah. Okay. I move, well, Director Jordan moved for the internship committee to discuss and develop recommendations for intern oversight and supervision, as well as other tasks, the negotiation of future contracts, and everything else necessary for building a robust internship program. That's the motion made by Jordan, seconded by Hedges. Any board discussion on that motion? Any public comment on that motion? Art?
Thank you for using the English term, I move.
Love it. No, that's a great point. And any other board comment? All right. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions?
I abstain.
One abstention, Thurlow. So ordered. 6-0-1. All right. So was there any other discussion for the item on internship program? Item 3.6. Seeing none, we are now moving into item 3.7. P consider creation of a community engagement committee. As introduced by Director Hedges, at the last meeting, the board may discuss and take action on the creation of a community engagement committee. Additionally, the board will consider appointing members of the committee and assigning responsibilities to the committee. I'll say real quick that I think it's a great idea that we create such a committee. I also think it could be a great idea to make this an ad hoc committee so that the committee would be focused on specific short-term projects that would allow it to meet informally, though obviously reporting back to the board, but that would not require the notice of the secretary and the full public meeting process. That would be my recommendation.
So moved.
Okay.
A second.
State the, if you could give me a little more specific.
I move that we form an ad hoc community engagement committee.
Do you want to make, because it's ad hoc, we don't have to have members, right?
Do you want to, well, there do need to be members. You can direct the board president to appoint them.
That got really confusing last time. Can we just include it in this motion?
Yeah, we can include it.
Include who's going to be on this
committee. Yeah, so we don't have to do the whole runaround.
So who's going to be on the committee? You're going to chair it. Who else is going to be on the committee?
Anyone else have time to join this committee?
Are we doing this right now?
Yes.
I would like to, can we have a discussion about what the goal of the committee is before we start?
Yeah,
I agree.
I don't
think it's friendly with the makers. Okay, yeah, so
yeah,
please.
Dive in, okay. If we are to truly be a community service district, it means we must serve the whole community. In order to understand the service needs of the whole community, we must first have outreached to that community, not just to the usual suspects, the university at all, but to all of those in the community, to every corner of the community. And only then can we truly fulfill the mission that we have been elected for and that the district has been created for. This is a fundamental task that's got to be front-loaded, ad hoc though it ought to be, and I think that is appropriate, but it needs to be done and done soon.
Awesome. So perhaps in that, I mean, I think you you stated it greatly, to focus on reaching out to the whole community to ensure that no segments of the community are left out of the CSD's function?
Yes, and I believe that fulfills all of the usual mandates of an entity like ours, such as cultural competency and so forth and so forth and so forth. And I don't mean to minimize those. I think those are really sacred trusts. And if we're going to represent the community of Isla Vista one day, we need to prove it by serving them all.
Excellent. Since this is an ad hoc committee, I believe that we are allowed to go to appoint it to serve up to 6 months.
I think it's nine.
Mm-hmm.
Up to nine. I heard it. Mm-hmm. What's that?
Yes.
Nine? Okay. Did we want to do something more in the short run and then we could extend it at a time? Like, I mean, I think that perhaps a good thing to do would appoint this committee for the first 3 months. I think that's a good amount of time to try it.
I think it should extend through this summer.
I'm going to say five.
First five.
Five.
Okay.
Yeah, because the way that I see this, this committee is going to do a lot of the groundwork for forming the processes through which community outreach is going to be done. And we, as we just discussed, we're going to have some sort of a renegotiation of an MOU regarding an internship program coming back to us in time for the beginning of the fall academic quarter, so it would make sense to have community outreach be involved in that discussion in terms of the interns' roles and responsibilities, how they fit into the committee, what the committee's role is going to be going forward. Mm-hmm.
So
that would be, is that 5 months or is that six?
what are we, right now we're in.
I want five, just in the motion. 6 months is half a year. I don't like that.
Right, and I think for
let's look at the calendar.
And I think we're talking about the first X amount of months of the district's operation, so this takes into account time that has already
elapsed.
Okay.
Perfect. 5 months sounds great.
And this was made by
me, so that's why I said 5 months.
Cool. I move that we form an ad hoc committee, an ad hoc community engagement committee, to ensure that in the
oh no, this is made by George. We got to make some moves here.
Yeah.
I really think we
seconded by you.
Yep, seconded by me.
Okay, let me just get as it's been made and seconded, and then we'll
5 months.
Actually, so I move that we form an ad hoc committee, ad hoc community engagement committee, to ensure that in the first 5 months of the district's operation, of the district's existence.
Okay, contact your friend. You gotta finish the motion.
All.
Well, it was that, it was the language of the father.
Okay, so then what we have is. I move that we form an ad hoc committee, ad hoc community engagement committee, to ensure that in the first 5 months of the district's existence, the CSD serves the whole
community. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. You don't have to put any language in about nuts. Not just the usual suspects.
Oh, okay, I was
getting that. That's
assumed. So if the board doesn't take further action, just for clarification, this committee, its existence will terminate on September 1st, 2017, which would be five months from the...
I think it would be the 7th.
It's not going to terminate.
Formation.
If you look at this, it says to ensure
you're right.
The first 5 months.
Well, the ad hoc...
It'll expire when an ad hoc committee expires.
Well, so the ad hoc committee will be done upon its final report to the board, at which time it has no more work to do.
No, I like the way that it is, because it, and Natalie clarified what I was asking, which is like, is the committee just going to go away arbitrarily? Because I'm against that. I don't think that's a good idea. Yeah, you're right. The committee will expire when it expires, but for the first 5 months, this is what the committee's tasked with.
Yeah.
And at the end of that time, outreach will have become part of the board's culture, and we will not necessarily have the need for an ad hoc committee to get it started. Mm-hmm.
That's great.
That's
I love that idea.
Really cool.
How beautiful.
It's good. So
we're gonna really push for this.
So let me just confirm with Director Thurlow that I understand his motion.
That's the motion.
Move that we form an ad hoc community engagement committee to ensure that in the first 5 months of the district's existence, the IVCSD serves the whole community of Isla Vista.
Okay. Do you want to put people on there so that we don't have to do that again?
Do you want me to assign people? To
if that's the intent of your motion.
Who wants to serve on that committee?
Chair.
I'd like to draft.
Director Freeman, are you interested?
Yeah.
Cool.
You're on.
And I think that's great. So, and...
It's like dodgeball. I pick you.
And that.
Dr. Hedges serves his chair.
Okay, so... With all of our other committees, we've had it, the committee elects the chair. Do we want the board setting the chair for this committee? Or do we want to keep it uniform with what we've had?
Just to let them work it out in the committee. There's no reason.
Yeah, we'll let the committee
select
the
chair.
Yeah. let me just make sure I have it right down right. So what I have right now is move that we form an ad hoc community engagement committee to ensure that in the first 5 months of the district's existence, the IVCSD serves the whole community of Isla Vista, and that Director Hedges and Director Freeman serve on the ad hoc committee. That was made by Thurlow, and was that seconded by Jordan? And question from Director Freeman.
Okay, so first of all, as discussed in our last board meeting, the inability for people to vote on being appointed to the committee. And so at this point now, we, I mean, like, if we're only putting two people on the committee, we'd still have five people voting, so that seems
right.
Okay, but I just want to point out that I want to verify, we are only putting two people on this committee?
Well, as of now.
Okay. I think as of
ad
now.
Hoc.
Unless, are there any other people who want to be appointed at this time?
Can it be, must it be board?
Well, that's the next
in
item.
In light
I
of the next
this,
item.
This
yeah.
segues
yes.
perfectly into the next
yes.
item.
And one thing that I'll say from that is, at looking at an opinion from the Los Angeles city attorney on ad hoc committees of their neighborhood councils, what they had there is an ad hoc committee is comprised solely of members of the governing body. However, that does not preclude the committee from meeting with people who are not on the body.
And so then I was going to actually, I know that, I mean, Father John's recent work is on here, and he seems interested in the ad hoc committee, but I wanted to get an understanding of why we're choosing an ad hoc committee for this.
Actually, the idea is that I think at least our committee talked about becoming an ad hoc committee. There was some pushback from the public about
our meeting formation.
Yeah.
I believe, in fact, all the committees have now talked about turning it into an ad hoc committee.
Right. But I think this one in particular has the issue of you're doing a whole bunch of community outreach, you're out there talking to a whole lot of different people, and I think that the Brown Act noticing requirements are going to be onerous for this particular committee more so than the other committees.
Agreed.
It would stand to reason that the committee members are going to be directly involved okay. with outreach, and so we can notice you everywhere you go. When you go
yeah.
to, serving food in the park to
okay.
hand out agendas.
And I'll say that based on the current standing committee load, I don't know that I could vote to create another standing committee tonight, just based on what I see the current workload and
cool.
That I really think we need to make sure we're taking this at a pace that we can all
mm-hmm.
keep up.
I think it works well.
Director Freeman?
Yeah.
And then I just have one clarification with Father John's description of the committee. So this is about outreach and information dissemination and return of information back to the board. Is it about project construction? When you say like to serve, does it mean that we're going to be
the discretion
deciding
of
to do something, or is it? Or is it? And if so, I might actually add some concerns
it
to that.
I envisioned, at least you
okay.
know, as I was describing, and as I've thought about it, that we would bring things back to the board of what we heard. Here's what the people
okay.
are saying.
Yeah, and just like any other committee, committees are advisory to the board.
Yeah.
Though the board can direct committees
yes.
to carry out tasks.
It's vox populi.
Okay.
Hmm. Any other board discussion before I go to the public? Public comment on this item. Art?
Wouldn't your interns be handy to run around and determine these methods of getting the public votes?
I think that's a great idea.
That's a great idea.
That'll be handled by the internship.
Yeah.
Okay. And, okay, any other public comment? Seeing none, back to the board, any board comment? All right, I'm just gonna read the motion as we have it and then call the question. Motion is move that we form an ad hoc community engagement committee to ensure that in the first 5 months of the district's existence, the IVCSD serves the whole community of Isla Vista, and that Director Hedges and Director Freeman serve on the ad hoc committee. All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All those opposed? Any abstentions?
Abstain.
Abstain.
Two abstentions from Freeman and Hedges. Motion passes, 5 in support, 0 opposed, 2 abstentions, so ordered. Thank you so much for leading this.
Woo, yeah.
Awesome. All right. Now, discuss options for members of the public to serve on committees. So I did some more research, and I looked at policies, and I haven't found anything that sets a specific like protocol set by the law that we need to follow with this. My recommendation would be, and I'd love to hear anyone else's recommendations, because we really got to figure out how to do this, but I think perhaps we direct a member of this board to make some form of public announcement, allowing members of the public to submit letters of interest to be placed on the next agenda, and somewhere in that motion include a number of days. So letters of interest will be accepted until this date.
Can I make a motion? I would move that we refer this to the policy committee. I think it's a little bit of a can of worms in terms of soliciting the public, and then who's going to review it and how that's going to work, all those things. So I would move that we refer this to the policy committee to have a set of policies for public involvement on committees for the next board meeting.
A second.
So just to confirm, moved by Thurlow, seconded by Jordan. Move to refer this to the policy committee to set up policies for public involvement on committees, or public involvement?
Public involvement. Public participation.
Public participation in committees?
Yeah.
And that the committee report back at the next board meeting.
Correct.
Okay, moved by Thurlow, seconded by Jordan. Any board discussion? Director Geist.
I just think as you expand these, if you expand these standing committees, which I, you know, through my first thing, I just go, oh, this is hard to find a cadence and make it work and get stuff done and be productive. We run into the second committee and, oh, we can't get the room, or the three board members can't meet. Now you put in volunteers and you got to check their schedules. I mean, it just gets to be a little mushroom cloud that you can't manage. And so, I mean...
It's a good point.
We've multiplied our committees and we've multiplied the dates we're going to meet, and we've, you know, I've been in Isla Vista for a long time. I remember the GPAC and the PAC, and we met nauseously for hours on hours, and we created a $3.6 million plan, and it never got implemented. And so, you got to remember, yeah, I love the public process. I think IV is all about the public process, and it needs to be included. But there's also some cadence. You got to get stuff done. And so,
one thing that I'll mention, because I think there's many ways to look at it, and I think that's definitely one of the top ones. But one thing that was also pointed out to me by a member of the public is through public participation on the committees, it expands the voting members of the committee, which could allow for a quorum in which members of the committee could discuss committee work outside of the meetings. So just one plus side to it, because right now at standing committee meetings, committee members cannot communicate with each other outside of those. But I mean, I think both are things to keep in consideration. I also understand that many of these committees have put on their next meeting agenda discussions related to the moving into an ad hoc committee to make it easier to meet. So no matter what, I think that at least one of these committees will have public participation. So I do think it's important for the policy committee to determine a policy. But I
think like one of my biggest things on a committee is just talking to the secretary to set the agenda, because he's on my committee. And so it just makes it really hard to get to say, hey, here's an item I want to put on, and what's the language of that item? It almost means I just have to simply set all the items, and that's what's going to be on there. We can't have a discussion about the content of the agenda.
And I'll say that is what I would recommend from members of the board who want to put items on respective committee agendas for those whose committees have assigned the board secretary with creating their agendas, or creating and maintaining their agendas, because I understand that's not the case for at least one of the committees. So, but yeah, I want to echo those concerns 100%.
Yeah, I'm moving in that direction. It's just in your mind, you have to.
Yeah,
totally. And just to restate the motion that we're considering is to refer this policy committee to set up policies for public involvement
for public participation in committees, and that the committee report back at the next board meeting. Any other board discussion on this? Any public comment? Ben?
If there's going to be an intern program starting on the 3rd, it seems like the 4th might be a bit early to actually make any policy decision from, or any permanent decision by the board until the internship program is actually shaped fully.
I'm not sure that this motion pertains to that so much. Any other public comment? No more board comment on this? All right, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed? Any abstentions? Motion passes 7-0, so ordered. All right. Now, oh my gosh, section 4, future meeting dates and agenda items. This is so nice. Oh. It's not even 11:45 yet. I don't know.
Can we have a break?
I don't feel like I've done an honest day's work. All right. Future meeting dates and future agenda items. So our next regular meeting is scheduled for April 4th, 6 p.m., as confirmed in this calendar that we've approved but has set at our last meeting. At this point, I'm sure the board secretary would love to hear future agenda items.
Yeah, first I just want to read off the ones that I've already identified. The first is future funding options or funding sources agenda item that includes the attachment of the letter from the university's director of capital development, Chuck Haynes, outlining the university's contribution that was entered into the public record under our agency officially. Let's see, I'm trying to read my janky handwriting and pick out other ones. I know that there were other ones that people had asked me to add. Just shout them out if you know.
Donations?
Yes, so that would be included
under the funding
item, yes.
Tax exemption.
Insurance. Update on the website.
Yeah, great point.
Update on.
So report back on website progress.
Yeah, same with insurance.
Yeah. Did we get direction? We didn't direct anyone for insurance,
direction,
right?
On insurance.
We did. Did we not?
Information.
What
insurance? Ed insurance, yeah.
I don't think we moved that though at this meeting.
Yeah, the formation's gonna, chair is gonna put it on the formation.
I think,
Ethan,
you can just refer it back to us, right? It doesn't need to be a.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, totally.
Yeah.
But, Darcel, you didn't get any motion about insurance, right? Mm. Yeah, I didn't either.
Yeah,
no, but Natalie's asking if we have an item on the next board meeting for insurance.
It. Oh, mm-hmm. Okay.
And it will be anticipated
that
the formation committee might have something to say about that.
Might
okay, so formation committee recommendations.
Yes.
Excellent.
Wait, so is it formation committee recommendations or insurance?
Well, if they have a recommendation on insurance, they'll send that to you.
Yeah.
Yeah, but is the item for insurance or for their recommendations?
It falls that way
to their
one of those ABC things.
Okay, yeah, okay.
And then I also wanted to add the Associated Student Senate of UC Santa Barbara was wondering if the CSD would like a spot put on their agenda for the CSD to have an assigned spot to speak whenever they want at the beginning of the meeting. So like it usually goes like university representative, chancellor's representative, university representative, UCPD representative, and then they skip to public forum, but in that space it would also have an E that would say CSD representative. So just
sounds
because
good.
We're all here, we would have to, I would hope that we could make a motion to formalize it.
Cool. And perhaps we can, I think that's awesome. And other things would be assign CSD members to represent the CSD at Isla Vista Community Network meeting, perhaps?
Yeah, just representation. Can we talk about like external representation?
Yes, we could have
a discussion topic on that.
Yeah,
that would be
okay.
Great.
Another group
so
would be Isla Vista
to
save.
Right now, I'm
thinking
that I'll make two separate items. There will be this approval of a standing item on ASUCSB's Senate.
Which we can't actually, because the bill hasn't been written by ASUCSB Senate, but I'd like to have a formal motion put in place. So I think that whatever wording comes into play has to make sure that it doesn't sound like we're bossing them around.
But what it could also
okay.
be is assigning someone.
Do you get what I'm saying? Oh, so you know when, okay. So like,
because I've spoken to a senator about this.
Yeah, totally. Yeah. I just want to make sure that it's not like us seeming like we just formalized it, because they still have to go through the legislative process on their end to make it actually formalized.
No, not at all.
And I think what we'd be doing here is assigning someone to represent us
mm-hmm.
there, whether or not there's a formal one
yeah.
or
yeah,
in
I
public
agree.
Comment. Cool.
Awesome. Thank you.
Okay.
Agreed.
So there will be one item, and it'll be external representation.
Perfect. Thank you.
And unless there's any other items thought of now, they can be emailed to the board secretary.
Correct.
Are there any more items that members of the board wish to place on at this time?
And assume that committee recommendations will be agendized.
Yep.
Ooh.
All right. Art?
In the donation, the item on the agenda, there are two nonprofits in Iowa, either one or both of which would probably agree to be a funding task
for the fiscal agent. Yeah.
Okay.
And you're referring to IVCDC.
I'm sorry.
Very cool.
And IV Think.
Cool. Okay. So, and that, I believe, I will put that as a subpoint under funding items for the next meeting.
All right. And my understanding is that with the approval of the calendar earlier, we don't need to take any more action to schedule those special meetings at this time, right?
No,
just announce them.
Okay.
Or just announce
well,
the next
I think we did
meeting.
That earlier. Because
well,
these
yeah,
will still need to be called. Like as the board president, I'll call the special meeting later on. That's something we'll probably discuss as we
oh,
get
yeah, closer.
Oh
yeah, no, I thought you were talking about the regular meeting. I was just saying you should read that.
Yeah, okay, so just the next regular meeting will be April 4th, 2017 at 6 p.m. in the community room, 970 Embarcadero Del Mar. Can I have a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Second? Who seconded that? Hedges? Jordan Hedges? Any public comment?
Like, it's time to leave.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstain? Motion passes 7-0. Have a good night.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Good job.
Thank you.
We're adjourning at 9:39 p.m.